IBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
So it's just one of those games where, you know, you have it at a good point and, you know, they have a scheme and what they're going to do. And I thought they did a really good job with it. And I thought we did a really good job with it. We just didn't make open shots. And the guys that we had shooting the basketball, you know, are guys that can make more than they do. But that's, you know, life on the road. It's part of it. Can you find a way to win a game when you don't shoot the ball well? And we were able to do that. But Nebraska deserved to win the game just as much as we did. I thought they were really good.
We got down early, but I thought we'd fall. You know, I can't fall the effort. I thought we gave great effort. But you got to give a lot of credit to this team. This Arizona team is a good team. They are. And we was challenged tonight. I got to do a better job of getting us in position, man. But I thought the game was won in the paint. And they were the better team tonight in the paint.
Most difficult thing about this game and the ugliest thing is the rebounding. And giving up 29 offensive rebounds, and it's an effort statistic. And so we just really had a poor effort. And, you know, the ball goes in the air. It's up for grabs. And they had almost as many offensive rebounds as we had total rebounds, which is hard to fathom. So very poor effort.
This is 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Shout out Eddie Garrison with the clips. Monday afternoon as of 12:01 p.m. Eastern Time. Matthew Thomas Ryan remains the starting quarterback of the Indianapolis Colts. And our old pal Carson Wentz was just activated from injured reserve by the Washington Commanders. Jimmy Cook, I'm Brendan King. Eddie Garrison's on the ones and twos. Jimmy, let me just read you this. Per our guy Kevin Bowen, who just tweeted from Jeff Saturday's press conference, Matt Ryan, quote, gives the Colts the best chance to win. Heading into Saturday afternoon football against the Minnesota Vikings. Your thoughts, Mr. Cook?
Look, on Friday on this program, I came in and I said that I felt like the Colts should lose their last four games. That's what I'd want to root for if you're a Colts fan, because you want to get yourself in the best position draft-wise. Now, NFL players don't think that way. Coaches don't think that way. That's obvious. That was kind of given. Maybe I didn't clarify that on Friday, but I want that known now. People are fighting for jobs, not just with the Colts next year, but for players that are going to be potentially traded for or signed elsewhere. They're not going to just sit down as a collective and be like, yeah, we're going to try to lose this game on purpose. No, it doesn't happen. Okay. I understand that. It's not lost on anybody. So from that angle, I guess I get what Jeff Saturday means when Matt Ryan gives you the best chance to win, I suppose, because of everybody that's out there, minus the mystery box that is Nick Foles, since we haven't seen him this year.
Yeah, truly.
Matt Ryan probably does give you the best chance to win with what's out there. So I'm not surprised that's what he's saying. Do I think that's what it's going to be on Sunday or Saturday? It's very early right now in that process, but yes, I do think that Matt Ryan's going to end up being your starter if I'm taking Jeff Saturday at his word. And I don't see why. Look, I mean this, and this, there's no, never mind, I'm not even going to say that with all due respect, part, because this is a disrespectful thing I'm about to say.
The Vikings
are not worried who is going to be under center for Indianapolis on Sunday or Saturday. So I don't buy the gamesmanship of, oh, we're going to say it's Matt Ryan, but then is that Sam Ehlinger's music? No, I'm not worried about that. He can say what he wants. Ryan starts great, but they have their hands full. You saw what happened against top tier competition in Dallas last week, but then again, when this team still had hope, you saw what they did to Kansas City. So they've been a helter-skelter team all year. I'm not mad at Saturday. He's fighting for, if he still wants to be a coach, he's fighting for his job too. He has to put the lineup out there that he feels is best.
By God, that's Nick Foles. Well, I think what you said, you brought up a good point about Foles, because it truly is like playing 500 in your backyard in the middle of summer, and a kid just launches a mystery box, and then you catch it.
Yep.
And there's a high likelihood the kid's going to say bankrupt.
Right.
But there's also a high likelihood that you just get 500 points if Nick Foles ends up appearing in the game against the Minnesota Vikings. Vikings, by the way, lose yesterday to the Detroit Lions. The Lions suddenly could be a playoff contender. They're 6-7. The Vikings are 10-3. They just got their behind whooped, and now they host the Colts on Saturday Night Football. Charlie Clifford sent this tweet a few moments ago. Matt Ryan has played about 44 quarters of football with the Colts this year, Jamie. He has 13 interceptions, worst in the NFL. He has 14 total fumbles, worst in the NFL. 5 of those fumbles were lost and recovered by the defense. That's tied for worst in the NFL. 18 total turnovers. That's worse than the NFL. And 14 total touchdowns. He remains the starter in Minnesota. I guess, though, Jimmy, I'm not trying to peg it all on Matt Ryan because it is certainly not his fault. Right. The offensive line has not performed. Jonathan Taylor seemingly has gotten back to his usual work. But look, Jimmy, when you have the wide receiving core, as you do, Pittman has struggled. I will say Jelani Woods has been a nice bright spot, but I just don't know, and this is just the story of the year, what a lot of people were saying heading into the campaign. I just don't know how you compete with, to kind of throw Alec Pierce out of the equation, because Pierce has been fine, but your secondary options being Paris Campbell, who has been better, but Ashton Doolin as a three, that's just not going to win you these types of ball games, Jimmy, when you go into a tough environment in Minnesota against a team that arguably has been one of the juggernauts in the NFL this year.
And to your point, and I was talking with Eddie about this on the way in here today, they have flaws that are deeper than just Matt Ryan. Your overall point is that it's not just Matt Ryan's fault. And when you look around the AFC right now, look, the Colts, because the AFC South is so bad, will always have a fair amount of cushion each offseason to try to get back in the playoffs. I would argue, and again, this is looking into a crystal ball, right? It's hard to simulate out the next couple of years and what's going to happen because franchises change so often. But unless Trevor Lawrence and the Jaguars turn a corner and figure it out, which is very possible next year.
They got a nice little W yesterday.
They did. They did get a nice W, and they've shown strides throughout the year that they're building things the right way, and they're coming, right? I thought there'd be a little bit more this year, overestimated them a bit. But they're coming. They're knocking on the door, and they're ready to be a part of this AFC South conversation. My larger point, though, Brennan, is that you look around the rest of the AFC, and why I say even with the expanded playoffs that have been a part of the NFL the last couple of years, a permanent fixture in the sport, the Colts are not, in my mind, one move away, unless it's a home run miracle quarterback that you're starting right away. They're not one move away from catching the Bengals. They're not one move away from catching the Dolphins. They're not one move away from catching the Chargers. Those are all bottom teams that are in the last portion of the wild card right now. They're more in that Jets, Patriots, Jaguars category, which is the 8-10 seed of the playoffs currently. But even still, the Jets have shown more impressive strides this year. The Patriots is probably a better comparison, Patriots, Jaguars, as it stands right now. And there are a lot of question marks that are going to have to be filled this offseason. The one that you could say doesn't need as many answers would be on the defensive side of the ball because they played so well. And that's why I'm so fascinated in this matchup against the Vikings, because just like against Dallas, your defense is going to be heavily tested throughout this contest. And it's another benchmark game where if you're in the Colts scouting department or if you're Chris Ballard or on his staff, you're monitoring everything these next 4 weeks, because while I, kind of ragged on Jeff Saturday a little bit about the, this for all the marbles, final four games of the season, while they're not really playing for anything postseason-wise, these are guys that want to still be a part of the team next year, and it's a big test against the Vikings.
It's for a lot of marbles for a bunch of guys on this football team.
Yes.
The pending free agent. Are you giving Paris Campbell a new deal? If you're Chris Ballard, those types of guys, the tweeners, that maybe, with all due respect, have had injuries, and shout out to Paris Campbell for what he's gone through. But look, Jimmy, this is a business, and that's a lot of money to pay a guy that has not, quite frankly, been a factory for your football team over the years. I do want to say as well, when you talk about catching up to the likes of the Dolphins or the Bills, other teams in the league this year that have kind of put their fingerprint on maybe competing in the AFC for years to come. I mean, the Chargers looked pretty good last night. I'm concerned, Jimmy, with catching teams in the division. Now, the Titans didn't play their best game yesterday. Tannehill looked very average. And much of that team looked pretty melancholy, too. But the Jaguars go get a win. Trevor Lawrence throws 3 touchdowns. He had 368 yards, Jimmy, completing 30 of 42 passes.
Doug Peterson is the perfect coach for this guy. And he's only in year number two, and that's really spooky. The Texans, of all people, competed with the Cowboys yesterday. And of the Texans QBs that played, be it without both Brandon Cooks and Nico Collins in the lineup, they were playing a bunch of XFL dudes. And they competed with the Cowboys. Jeff Driscoll had the only touchdown pass for the Houston Texans yesterday. Damian Pierce, who I really like, 78 yards on the ground and a touchdown. Remember, the Texans is the last game of the year for the Colts. And they just competed with the Cowboys, who might be fake. We don't know. Cowboys are 10-3. They get a win, by the way. Cowboys come back to win. That last drive by Dak, 98 yards, really, really good. But the Texans, of all people on the road, compete with the Cowboys yesterday.
There's only a handful of teams that get this designation, right? And this is me just kind of trying to explain the unexplainable, which is the obvious cliche thing to say is, Brennan, it's any given Sunday. You never know. You got to play the games, all that. But
Al Pacino.
The other cliche thing to say, and you see it against division opponents all the time, and then you see it in in-state matchups all the time, right? Like, it just, you can play these games as much as you want. More often than not, if one team takes their foot off the gas, or if one team does not perform to their standard, which the Cowboys did not do yesterday, a lot of pride on the line, a lot of jobs on the line. Am I surprised that the Texans gave them as much trouble as they did? Yes. But I was also surprised that Denver hung in with Kansas City as much as they did yesterday. Yeah. So, I mean, it's just that one, the Texans point, I know you're saying that's a matchup to watch out for the end of the year, and I agree with you on that. But I don't put them in the same breath as the Jaguars in terms of their knock on the door and they're right there with the rest of the South. The Texans are still a dumpster fire, all things considered. Jaguars just 5-8. I know I did. And again, this is easy to say, right? Because there's four teams in the division. So you're essentially throwing a dart. But I had them as my dark horse pick in the South this year. They're not going to get
Jags.
But because I expected Trevor Lawrence to take another step forward, he's been a roller coaster this year. But yesterday, he showed what Doug Peterson and company want to have out of their franchise quarterback. So I think the Jaguars are closer to the Texans. Long term, I'm less worried about. They're an absolute mess. Jacksonville is more where I'm saying this goes from a two-horse race to a three-horse race in the South heading into this offseason.
Jimmy, I would say never on Jacksonville. I mean, they're only two games out of the AFC South.
It's a great point. That's a good point, Eddie. And
they have New York, Houston, and Tennessee left on their schedule.
Man, wouldn't that be something?
Can you say that one more time?
Jacksonville has New York, Tennessee, and Houston and Dallas left on their schedule. And they're only two games. Jets.
Wow.
Yes. So they have, there's a realistic shot where they could backdoor this thing in with how bad Tennessee has played lately.
They've been terrible.
And how much of that, like, how much would that infuriate Colts fans? It's like, you see Jacksonville now. They come out of nowhere and they make a run and dethrone the Titans of the AFC South. Tennessee has the Chargers, Texans, Cowboys, and Jacksonville. So it'll be interesting to see how the rest of the AFC South plays out.
Yeah, so here's my thing about the Jets. So the Mike White experiment, that was going to blow up in their face. Absolutely. Because the same thing happened last year, if you guys remember. Because the Jets came to Lucas Oil Stadium on that Thursday night football game, prime time. So Mike White last year, October 24th, 202 yards against the Patriots. He threw a touchdown and two picks. Then his coming out game was on that Halloween against the Bengals. 405 yards, three touchdowns, 37-45. Then he came here 7-11 with 95 yards. And Mike White took a beating yesterday. To be fair, he hung in there against the Bills for sure. But this was just going to blow up in the face of the Jets. Zach Wilson is not even dressing. Joe Flacco is their backup. I think Eddie Flacco came in for two plays yesterday, and the first play he got just absolutely demolished. So
yeah, he held on to the ball too long.
The fact that the Jets... So, one more time, Eddie, give me that schedule for the Jags.
For the Jaguars?
Yeah.
Let me get it back up. I was on Tennessee's, but they have, in order, they will face the Dallas Cowboys. That is a home game. Then they have to go on the road to New York and face the Jets. That's on a Thursday night, the 22nd. On New Year's Day, they have to go to Houston to face the Texans, and they round out their season on January 8th against the Tennessee Titans at home.
Jimmy, that's a winnable.
They need to go
playoff contender.
They need to go 2-1 over their next three, and have the Titans go 1-1. Yeah, that's what they need to happen. They need the Titans to go 1-2. They need to go 2-1 their next three, and then essentially that Week 18 matchup between Titans and Jaguars could decide the division. if that's what happens.
I think that's why. So
now I'm not plessing all the permutations here because I'm using the New York Times playoff simulator. You can also use 530.
Is that more reliable than the NBA trade simulator?
I understand, but this is an actual algorithm and model which lets you put the matchups. I understand. Whatever. Either way, the Colts impact things too, depending on how they do in their matchups. But if you assume the Vikings beat the Colts and the Chargers beat the Colts, Jaguars, it could be Jaguars Titans for the South, which is a crazy thing to utter. That's a great point, Eddie. Good observation on your part. And so, yeah, so maybe it's not as crazy that they're a dark horse that wins the South. And if that happens, and you're Jim Irsay,
oh,
not only is this the team that bounced you last year, but that got you again once this year, and on top of that, you were supposed to be in this
shutout.
Right. And you were supposed to be in this two-horse race Tennessee all year. Not only have you faded down the stretch, but from the back of the pack come the Jaguars and could potentially steal the South.
And it's Frank Reich sensei that's leading the charge.
Yep.
Ooh, baby. They got to figure out, Jimmy. They got to figure out the NFL scheduling. So Tennessee is going to play Jacksonville twice in a matter of 5 weeks. And the Colts played
the Titans.
They played all their AFC South games but one before Halloween.
Right.
I don't know how you figure that out, but something's got to be done.
So, in hindsight,
I don't know if the Chiefs have the same type of deal, but
well, yeah, they do because they haven't played Denver all year. That was their first game.
That's just so wild.
Yeah. So, I don't know enough about the scheduling process. I will say though, having some division games stacked towards the end of the season, the beginning of the season is what bugs me. I want them to matter late. They don't really matter for the Colts late anymore. But Jaguars, Titans, they very well could. So, like, it's situational, right? Beginning of the year, it stinks. End of the year, if your team's not in contention anymore, like Denver, the fact that you're playing Kansas City twice right now, it's meaningless. Like, you're playing for pride, you're playing for jobs, like we talk about, but there's nothing on the line there. For Jaguars, Titans, a lot on the line. Opportunity to potentially punch a ticket to the postseason. That's crazy. I'd be honest with you. I thought the Jaguars were all but on the mat, but now looking closer at their matchups the next couple of weeks, and the Titans, like, it is very easy for the Titans to go 1-2 over the next three. They play the Cowboys and they play the Chargers still, and I would pick both Dallas and Los Angeles in those two matchups, and I wouldn't think twice about it.
I do think it's pretty wild.
That's not true. Vrabel and the Chargers are Vrabel's a good defensive mind.
My thing with Vrabel is that dude could just lock it down at any time.
Sure.
He's kind of like a Belichick maybe it's because he played for Bill Belichick. But, you know, Bill, over the last couple of years since Tom Brady left New England, I mean, it's been a crapshoot when it comes to New England. But on Monday Night Football tonight, Jimmy, if they just locked down the Cardinals on the road, would that surprise you in the slightest? It wouldn't surprise me?
No, it wouldn't.
Even though, I will say, I'm starting the Arizona Cardinals defense in fantasy. I need 13 points from them, and I make the fantasy playoffs.
It's big time.
I'm scared.
You got champagne on ice?
Well, I don't know,
Jefferson,
man.
Jefferson at all?
What's that?
You have Justin Jefferson at all?
I do not have Justin Jefferson, and I did not start. Jimmy, you're going to hate me for this. You know what? We said this on Friday. I did not start Van Jefferson, who scored a touchdown at 44 yards with the Rams. I also did not start Jerick McKinnon, who happened to have 28 fantasy points.
Well,
and I started both Damian Pierce and who was my other running back? Some bum. Who was my other running back? Raheem Mostert, who had 37 yards.
I wouldn't have killed you as much for that because you never know what Kansas City is going
to
do.
Yeah, but then you just look
like
an idiot when you leave 28 points on the bench.
It's a tough look.
Are you alive in fantasy?
I got a bye week, yep.
You got a bye week?
Got a bye week going next week, yep.
I've got a bye week next week.
As in you didn't make the playoffs?
No, I made it.
You made it.
I was the one seed, so
wow.
I got a bye. Yeah.
Man, did you just draft really well?
I did. I got Travis Kelce in like the third round.
That's pretty good.
Let it slip, and I was like, no way. Got to take it.
Well done. I want to pivot for a second because additionally in that open that you heard, I appreciate some in the YouTube chat and on Twitter liking the open that they put together. Monster week in college basketball as we're enjoying more and more holiday hoops. Purdue survives, takes care of business in the end against Nebraska on the road in the Big Ten. Never an easy task. Matt Painter's group able to get it done. And on the other side of the state for the Hoosiers, no Jalen Hood-Schifino. BK, I know we're going to talk to Don Fischer about that coming up here at the bottom of the hour, but I felt like that was pretty glaring to start the game for Indiana. you could tell from an offensive flow standpoint that you saw the glaring issues last year, and you add in Hood-Schifino to go along with Xavier Johnson, I think they make that offense flow more. And against a high-powered, fast-paced team like Arizona, you could tell they were missing them, and they were indecisive at times on offense. That being said, though, they had runs in that game, had opportunities. I'm not necessarily pressing the panic button on the Hoosiers, except for maybe on the defensive end a bit. Giving up north of 80 points, not a good recipe for success, particularly early on in the year.
To me, Jimmy, and I'll get into Indiana here in a sec, but that's a top-five team that Arizona's going to have in a very short period of time. I love the John Rothsteinism for Arizona. Tommy Lloyd, grab your passport, because they show like all the countries that their guys come from. Like, we got Estonia and Sweden and like the big guys from Africa. I mean, goodness gracious. But look, Jimmy, I mean, at some point, Mike Woodson and his guys are going to have to learn how to win without a freshman. I mean, that's just the way college basketball works. And I would like to ask Don Fischer about what Race Thompson did late in that first half. Back-to-back three. They left him wide open. Race Thompson is not going to be a three-point threat in the Big Ten. At least you would think so. But if he can make a three or two, Jimmy, a game, that brings a totally different feel to Indiana's offense, because at least if he can show he can make that, Race Thompson, that will make somebody guard him when he's on the perimeter. And that just means there's one less guy in range of Trace Jackson Davis on the block.
Right. Anytime you can add a wrinkle in or have another aspect of the offense, it's going to open up more things for Trace Jackson Davis, which is where your bread is buttered in terms of that offense. I'm all for it. On top of that, when you look at just the opportunity to see where the rest of the season goes, and I hate to say this, but the way the bigs played, and there'll be adjustments made, but the way that the bigs of Arizona played in that game took down my hype level a little bit for when Zach Edey and the Hoosiers match up.
Yeah, well, but the problem, I guess, when you're scouting Purdue, when Edey comes out, you got to deal with Caleb first, then Trey Kaufman Wren, and then we talked with Rob Blackman on Friday. It's the Frankenstein factory of Matt Painter. In the basement of Mackey Arena, the guy is just molding big guys. Like, can we make this guy 7'7"? Is that possible? It's wild. It's just wild.
And the fact that it's, to your point, year over year over year, revolving door of just big time, big guys. It's frustrating for an Indiana fan, and you do nothing but tip your cap in terms of not only the way Matt Painter recruits, but again, that's a Nebraska team. Even though Indiana handled them at home, no sweat, Big Ten road environment, that's the type of test you're going to get. And Purdue managed to pass that test. That's all that matters at the end of the day.
Last year, Zach Edey had 12-9 against Indiana and 10-11. Played about 21 minutes in both of those games.
Well, we could probably say he's going to play more than 21 minutes against the Indiana Hoosiers this year. But that game, or those games, Jimmy, when we watch them this year, they're going to be down to the wire. I do not see a blowout coming on either side. The matchups on each end, Indiana's a little bit older. Purdue's freshmen have competed to this point. But what do you learn in college basketball year after year when you have a young team and it happens to everybody? It happens. If it doesn't happen to you, you might be the luckiest team in the country that your freshmen don't go through a growth spurt. And it usually happens right around January, maybe into February before the tournament. And it's then up to the coach, whoever that is, in this case, Matt Painter, to make sure his freshmen are ready for March. Because over the last couple of years, with all due respect, Jimmy, to the Purdue basketball program, North Texas and St. Peter's, you got to find a way to win in March. Good one coming up for you. We're going to talk to the voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fischer, after the timeout. Chris Denari at 1. He'll help preview Pacers Heat. My guy, the voice of the Oakland Athletics, Ken Korach, will join us at 1:30. Ken has been on with Jimmy and I before. He is an excellent baseball mind. And we'll talk a little hot stove, talk a little free agency with Ken. 2 o'clock, all things Colts, and maybe a little high school hoops with Greg Rakestraw. I'm Brendan King. That's Jimmy Cook. Eddie Garrison is on the ones and twos, hanging with you until 3 o'clock on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
How about this for the perfect holiday gift? Get moving again, pain-free. You can do that via QC Kinetics. They are the nation's leader in advanced regenerative medicine. taking unique protocols that use healing agents from your own body to target aching joints, repairing and restoring damaged tissue so you can move again with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. Got shoulder pain, excruciating hip pain? You have any arthritis or lingering pain from an injury, don't let them operate on you or give you more steroids. You call QC Kinetics with locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood and get a free consultation today. This is the future of joint pain management, and appointments are available as soon as the next week. So make 2023 the year you say goodbye to joint pain. Call QC Kinetics. That's 317-559-PAIN in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. Give QC Kinetics a call today. 317-559-PAIN.
Hey, it's Mark from Kevin and Query, and one of the things I love about betting on the NFL is I'm always finding new player or game props that I like. That's what's cool about FanDuel Sportsbook is you can combine these props with other bets from the same game to score an even bigger payout, and it's perfect for tonight's Monday night matchup between the Patriots and Cardinals. Give me the over in rushing yards for both Ramondre Stevenson and Kyler Murray, and DeAndre Hopkins as an anytime touchdown scorer. There's no feeling like nailing a same game parlay bet, so lock in your bet today on FanDuel Sportsbook. If you're new to FanDuel, sign up today with promo code MARK for your no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. It's promo code MARK, M-A-R-C, and while you're there, check out their everyday odds, boosts, and specials. The app is safe, secure, and easy to use, and when you win, you get paid fast. Make every moment more with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the NFL. 21 and over and present in Indiana. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is now withdrawable free bets that expire 14 days after receipt. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
There's no gift that's more beautiful, more versatile, and more meaningful than a beautiful piece of jewelry. And there's no better place to shop than Diamonds Direct, where celebrating memorable moments is our specialty. This holiday season, we've put together our most impressive selection of can't-miss gifts. Rings, earrings, pendants, bracelets, bands for every taste and every price range. And don't worry about higher prices and high interest rates. At Diamonds Direct, we've got your back with our guaranteed best value pricing and 3 years zero interest financing on any holiday purchase. That's right, zero interest financing. So that $5,000 eternity band is just over $138 a month. With this special offer, everything's affordable. So come to Diamonds Direct. Let our experts help you choose that perfect showstopper gift for this holiday season. Get holiday store hours, directions, finance details, and see our all-new online gift guide at DiamondsDirect.com. On approved credit, Diamonds Direct. Your love, our passion.
Pickup USA Fitness in Noblesville has a court ready for you.
And a whole lot more.
A massive gym.
Huge weight cardio and training room.
Two full-sized NBA courts.
One half court with Dr. Dish.
Up your game in your own time.
Your way.
And join in refereed pickup games beginning at 6 each evening.
A youth development league for young hoopers is available too.
And with memberships starting at only $39.99 a month.
What are you waiting for?
Sign up at PickupUSAFitness.com today.
Or call Scott at 317-316-5770.
Pickup USA Fitness Noblesville.
A better way to play.
Hey, JMV announcing the Connecticut Water System's end-of-the-year sale. Enjoy a savings blowout from now until December the 15th. Buy a Premier Series water softener. Get a K5 drinking water station free. You can even buy a Signature Series water softener and get 6 bags of salt free. $500 off an iron sulfur filter and get 50% off the Kinnick Salt Monitor. And use that with the app anytime, anywhere. It's the Connecticut Water December blowout sale. Call today, 800-444-1387. Hey, it's JMV, and sometimes the holidays bring not only added joy and cheer, but also increased expenses. Form Credit Union can help make the holidays easier with their unlimited cash back credit card. The money you get back from every purchase is applied right to your statement, making the next month's payment a little lighter. Plus, use your phone for secure mobile payments and get real-time alerts to make monitoring your account even easier. The unlimited cash back credit card at Form Credit Union. Find out more today. That's formcu.com. To apply. Hey, it's JMV for my guys John and Chris Love at Love Heating and Air Conditioning. Predictions are this could be a colder winter than normal, and you need to make sure your furnace is safe, efficient, and working properly before you have a breakdown on a sub-zero day. Get that recommended service right now from Love Heating and Air Conditioning, and the Love family will waive the $95 trip and diagnostic fee. I trust them, so should you. They're the best. Love-HVAC.com or 317-754-0754. Tell them JMV sent you.
Man, B-Dubs really has everything for football season. Fresh draft beer, big TVs, and saucy boneless bar pizza? Oh yeah. To make things even more legendary, they're teaming up with the Colts to offer you a free app anytime the Colts get a defensive takeaway, which is an interception or a fumble recovery in any game all season long. Valid at participating Indiana locations, free appetizer includes anything on the bar food section of the menu except house sampler and three bird dogs. Visit Colts.com/BWW for terms and conditions. Please drink responsibly.
Tired of your old car? Come into Auto Sales and Service and try one of theirs. Bad credit? No worries. Everyone gets approved. Visit their two locations, Auto Sales and Service.
The Ride with JMV.
Pacers rookie guard Andrew Nembhard with his 31 in their win over Golden State on Monday night. Just the latest example why you should tune in to the Pacers. I'm not suggesting at all this is a playoff team. They're probably going to lose more than they ever win, but fun as absolute hell to watch most of the time. Excitable, fun, with legitimate hope.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. It's Monday. It's 12:30. It's Fish. The voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fischer, joining 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Hoosiers fall 89-75 out west in Las Vegas. The voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fischer, nice enough to take some time with us here on a Monday. Don, how'd Vegas treat you?
Let's see. Let me think about this a second. Oh, yes, I was there for 6 days. I actually enjoyed myself out there without question. Had an opportunity to be a part of the National Football Foundation Awards program, and that was fun. And then got to play golf for 2 or 3 days, and then did a basketball game. So I had a good time.
Congrats again on the Schenkel Award. Very happy for you and your career being honored. And they joked on the Big Ten Network broadcast that Indiana had to twist your arm a little bit to stay out there an extra couple of days. So I'm sure that was fully accurate.
Well, totally accurate. There's no question about that. I wanted to come back in the worst way.
When you look at IU over that span, obviously the win over Nebraska and then against Arizona over the weekend, Fish, you had the best view of anybody in our view on the television sets at home. You could tell Jalen Hood-Schifino's absence was felt in that first half. Xavier Johnson gets in foul trouble. A 17-0 run happens for Arizona in that span. I think you got to give the Hoosiers credit and that they fought back, but where did you see the game get away from them, and is this a fixable point of the season for Indiana as they get ready to go to the Fog on Saturday?
Well, I don't think there's any question it's fixable. This is the early part of the year. This is when you're learning. This is when you're trying to put everything together. It's when guys are getting used to one another, especially the newer guys. And there's no question that Jalen Hood-Schifino, his absence factored into this loss. But I think the biggest thing about this ball game, from my perspective, was the first 10 minutes. You can't fall into a 19-point deficit at that point in the ball game and expect to be able to come back against a team of Arizona's caliber and win. You just can't do it. And without doubt, Indiana got off to a slow start. They didn't shoot the ball very well at the beginning. They ended up knocking down, I think, 10 three-point field goals in the game, but it was too little too late. And guys that were doing it, Race Thompson had 4 of those. That's unusual, to say the least. So you just look at it and you say, look, there's no question we got off to a slow start, whether that was because we went into the game rather casually or we just didn't anticipate how good Arizona was. Whatever the case may be, this is a basketball team that is still very much in the learning process. And it's a team that, in my opinion, still has a long way to go. I think they're a really good team. I don't think there's any question. They've got a lot of talent on this ball club, but I still think they're trying to find themselves as a group right now.
Hey, Fish, it's Brendan. First of all, congratulations. Secondly, I was in Vegas for a matter of like 5 days for the MLB winter meetings a few years ago. Anything more than 3 days in Vegas is just wild. My question, you led me right into it, about Race Thompson hitting 4 3-pointers. I know maybe you can't bank on that, but when he does shoot like that, What does that bring to the offense that can kind of loosen things up maybe for Trace Jackson Davis on the post?
Well, I think it brings quite a bit, to say the least. I mean, if you've got guys that can knock down the threes, but look, let's look at it from that first 10-minute period. Nobody in Indiana wasn't making threes at that point, and they basically took Trace out of the ball game at that juncture with how they played defense because they were double and triple teaming him at that point. And then, of course, when the three-point shot started to drop, things changed, and Indiana was able to come back. They made it a 10-point game at halftime. In the second half, they got it to three. They got it to five a couple of times. They literally had dug themselves just too deep a hole. And I will say this, Arizona is really good.
Yeah.
It's not like they're little sisters of the poor in any way, shape, or form. This is a really good basketball team. And Indiana, I give them credit for making the bounce back that they did, but it just wasn't enough. And when you dig that kind of a hole against a team like that, it's almost impossible.
Don Fischer, the voice of the Hoosiers, nice enough to join us. Don, I don't want to overreact to this, and I want to get your clarity on it since you've obviously seen the team and their growth this entire season as they continue to grow through the early portions of it. It felt like at times, this is an understatement, the bigs had their way down low against Indiana. How much of that was just the fast-paced nature of everything wearing down on Indiana, and how much of that is maybe an area where when they have matchups like Zach Edey and other bigs in the Big Ten that you're going to have to really knuckle down and learn from this?
Well, I think that's the key. I think learning from this opportunity, because the bigs for Arizona were really good. DeBellis is a terrific player. Balo is a guy that I don't think will ever play in the NBA. Not necessarily because he's not capable. He's just not as athletic or as explosive as those kinds of athletes now in the NBA are. And look at Kofi Coburn. He's not in the NBA. Why? Because he's not. He's kind of a plotter. A big, strong, physical guy, but he's not that athletic type guy that they're looking for these days. But Balo was terrific in this ball game. He had 15 points. Every time he touched the basketball, he was a factor. And that's going to be a problem for this Indiana ball club if Trace Jackson Davis, Race Thompson, Malik obviously is a young guy, but I still think, and he's kind of had plateaued here a little bit as a freshman in the last two or three ball games. Hasn't played quite what we saw in the early part of the season, but again, that's part of being a freshman, learning the situation. So the bigs are going to have to just do a better job. There's no question about that, Trace Jackson Davis included. I know he's a talented kid, and there's no doubt about the fact that he's been here for 4 years now, and he's a better player now than he ever has been previously. But you've got to be able to step up to the plate when the big boys come to town. And obviously Indiana had that from him last year in the Big Ten tournament. Those last three games he played in the Big Ten tournament were spectacular. And that's more of what we need to see out of Trace Jackson Davis on a consistent basis.
Fish, I know early on in the season, Mike Woodson got a question about Indiana's schedule and formatted the answer as to say, we tried to bring this schedule as close to the feel of the NCAA tournament as possible. So you play at Xavier, you beat number 18 North Carolina, you get a good test against number 10 Arizona, as you talked about. And now coming up, you get to visit number 6 Kansas. So bringing all those matchups together, what do you think that can help with most as you get towards March if you're Mike Woodson getting to face this big group of talent?
Well, I just think that anytime you face the really good teams in the non-conference portion of the schedule, it just helps you build toward the end of the season. And I've always felt that way. I've thought that Indiana's schedule in the past has been a little weak at times as far as non-conference ball games are concerned. I don't think you learn as much from some of these lesser ball games. I think you learned a lot more. You don't have to play every game against a top 10 or 15 type team, but you should play teams that are still comparable to your conference, if you know what I'm saying here. And I honestly think that that's one thing that Indiana has to do is upgrade that schedule and not be playing teams from the SWAC or the MEAC or some of these other lesser conferences that you're not going to get a real tussle from. And I think you learn from those tussles that you have in the early part of the season. I think that's, you're going to play some of the teams that are not that great and that kind of thing, but it can't be a majority of your games. I think you've got to get some really good mid-majors to come to your school or go to their school, whatever the case may be. I still think playing a Ball State or an Indiana State, those types of teams in your own state, I think they give you real tests because those kids all want to beat Indiana. And I think sometimes that we miss the boat in that regard. I think that that's why some of the time that Indiana hasn't progressed like we'd like to see them.
Don, in postgame, Coach Woodson was asked about the offense, and his counter was that, well, you know, we can't give up that many points on the defensive end. Offense didn't play that poorly. You're going to have a tough challenge, to Brendan's point, against Kansas on Saturday. A quick turnaround with that. Obviously, no updates yet on Jalen Hood-Schifino, but how do they turn around and try to adjust and get this defense back to where they want to with another top 10 opponent in Kansas in a road environment this weekend?
Well, I'm not a coach. I can only tell you that I think defense is effort. I think it's effort and toughness. And if those two areas aren't there, you're not going to beat people that are of this caliber. So you're going to have to come out and play your best defensive game. You're going to have to play much better than you did in the game against Arizona. And you got to follow the game plan. I can't answer this question in the sense of a coach's perspective.
Right.
I can only answer from the perspective of an announcer, a guy's been around
right.
a while and seen it. I just think you have to match whatever the other team puts out there. And a lot of times I haven't seen that from Indiana. I certainly didn't see it in the Rutgers game. I thought it's a perfect example of why Indiana got beat by Rutgers. They did not match their intensity level and the toughness that they put out on the floor, and that's something that this team has got to learn to do.
Fish, last thing for me, and you know, Jamie talked about the physicality of those two games, but I know the schedule is the schedule, but when you play Rutgers and Nebraska, you get a little taste of the Big Ten and just how physical the league is. Can those two games help you going into these massive non-conference contests against the likes of Arizona and Kansas?
Absolutely. I think there's no question about that. I think that's how you learn. I mean, let's face it. Again, playing some of these other lesser teams that Indiana has played in the past and even this year. I mean, when you look at the four games that Indiana is playing against the top-flight competition and then add in the two Big Ten games and the rest of the schedule that Indiana plays, no comparison, in my opinion. So I think that's one of the reasons I think you've got to upgrade your schedule a little bit more. And I think Indiana certainly could have done that this year, or they should have done that this year. But again, some of these schedules are put into place 2 or 3 years in advance, and there's simply no way to do it any other way.
Don, thank you again so much for making time for us. Congrats on the Schenkel Award once again, and for all you do for the world of broadcasting. And we look forward to talking to you next week. Enjoy the fog on Saturday.
The world of broadcasting. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, that's right. High praise here, Fish.
Congrats, Fish.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
That is the voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fischer. Nice enough to join us on the Mower Shop in Fishers hotline. Go see the Mower Shop in Fishers. Go to themowershop.com alongside Brandon King. I'm Jimmy Cook. Eddie Garrison manning the controls. You made a great point, as did Don, that if you're Indiana and you're looking at building block opportunities, you've had hostile environments already. You cannot get punched in the mouth on a neutral site court and expect to. They did respond, but eventually it's going to bite you, just like it did against Arizona. Came out with a lack of energy and tenacity against Rutgers. I guarantee you, if you come out and play the same way against the Jayhawks, you'll get run out of the gym.
Yeah, I can't wait to see Allen Fieldhouse with the Kansas Blue and the IU Crimson. I mean, those are just some things in college basketball that just make you smile. Getting to see those games, because I think Don brought up a good point. For a while there, we weren't getting this type of stuff. And then I think it really helped when they started doing the Champions Classic here and those types of non-conference ball games that weren't necessarily tournaments. They were kind of just one-offs, right? But the more and more you see it, I don't know if it's coaches are just trying to do the cool thing for recruiting, play these big types of games, but whatever has happened in the last 6-7 years, you're getting these types of blue blood games. I mean, heck, you're going to get IU Kentucky here in a couple years.
Right.
I mean, you got Kentucky and Gonzaga this year. You're getting these massive games. As college basketball fans, all of us here in the studio, I love it. And does it probably make life difficult on all the coaches? Sure as hell does. I'm cool with it, though.
I am as well. And from a city's perspective, like on the one hand, if you look at it from the Indianapolis standpoint, I miss the Champions Classic. I miss the Crossroads Classic. I miss having the crosstown rivalries. But when that dissolved And obviously, we're going to continue to talk about this week. Indy Classic now this weekend with featuring Purdue, Davidson, Illinois State, and
Ball State.
And Ball State. That's a great opportunity for those two programs of Purdue, who was a staple of the Circle City or the Crossroads Classic, a massive opportunity for them to continue their branding and a great opportunity for Ball State to remind everybody, hey, we're a part of this stage. We belong on this stage. To your larger point, though, that separation from that opened up this opportunity for Indiana to go play Arizona, to have a matchup with Kansas. It's hard to say that that's not, at least in terms of experience, it's a high level. That's a second weekend or third weekend matchup that you're looking at against Arizona if you're Indiana trying to sim out where you want to go this season.
I do really believe, though, that those Crossroads Classic games, what Don said about the Indiana kids on these Indiana teams, to be able to match up with a Purdue, to be able to match up with an IU. I mean, Alex Barlow hitting the buzzer beater against IU back, you know, that was a long time ago now. But it's those types of moments that maybe you don't have, but I think I'm willing to sacrifice that to be able to watch blue blood games like this.
9 years ago, Alex Barlow's shot against
Indiana. Man, you know more than me about my alma mater. Oh boy.
We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we will wrap things up in this hour, talk a little bit more about the Colts and transition a bit to the Pacers as the TV voice of the Pacers of Bally Sports. Chris Denari going to join us. Ken Korach, voice of the Athletics, bottom of the next hour, top of the 2 o'clock hour. Greg Rakestraw talking more Colts as well. Jimmy Cook and Brendan King here on The Fan.
Nobody plays more new country. 97.1 Hank FM.
Are these uncertain times making you nervous? Give Family Heating and Air a call. 317-577-8077.
Family Heating and Air is your trusted local independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
December 17th at Gainbridge Fieldhouse, introducing Indy's next basketball tradition, the inaugural Indy Classic. You don't want to miss this college basketball doubleheader featuring Ball State versus Illinois State and Purdue versus Davidson. The Indy Classic brings college basketball to the heart of downtown, and proceeds support the mission of Indiana Sports Corp. Secure your tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. Made possible by Indiana Sports Corp, Pacer Sports and Entertainment, and Russ Potts Productions.
Your love isn't confined to an advent calendar. It doesn't stop when the Christmas lights come down. With the Salvation Army, your love lasts all year long. It puts a present under someone's tree today and a roof over someone's head tomorrow. It brightens Christmas morning and the hardest nights for hardworking families. Together, we love beyond Christmas. Give $25 a month to support local families all year long at SalvationArmyIndiana.org.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in plumbing. That's Lance and his local team at LD Smith Plumbing. 317-284-9526. Let's talk about 83 of free involving any drain in your home. Means LD Smith is going to come out, make sure your drains are clogged free for $83, or the visit is free. That's 83 of free at 317-284-9526. The best in plumbing, Lance and his local team online, ldsmithplumbing.com.
Download the Dan Dockage podcast at 1075thefan.com or wherever you listen to podcasts. Brought to you by Affinity Whole Health, the leader in testosterone and hormone replacement therapy. Affinity Whole Health. FeelGreatIndy.com.
JMV is back on the road this Wednesday, 3 to 6 p.m. at Twin Peaks on East 82nd Street. Stop by for grub and ice cold beer. Thursday, the Tavern Tour continues, featuring Larceny Locks and Lunazool Shots from Coach's Tavern downtown at 28 South Pennsylvania from 3 to 6 p.m. Friday, it's JMV with another Bud Light Blue Friday from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Stop by and enter for a chance to win a pair of tickets to the Colts versus Chargers, all part of Bud Light Blue Friday.
Life's full of unexpected joys, like problems with water. That's why there's Michelis, a crew of 24/7 experts who are rescue ready, day or night, one phone call, for a gazillion disasters. Over three decades of restoring your home or business to better than new condition. Water, storms, fire, and foundations. Life happens. Michelis happens to help you through it. Call 844-FIX-INDY. Make it Michelis.
Catch another Bud Light Blue Friday broadcast with JMB from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill, Enter the football toss, and you could be the next fan to win a pair of tickets to see the Colts take on the Chargers.
The Colts head north to take on the first place Minnesota Vikings. The coverage starts Saturday morning at 10 on 97.1 Hank FM.
The Fan.
I'm Brendan King with Jimmy Cook, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan. Eddie Garrison, can you please get us an NCAA basketball top 25 update?
I wish I had a sounder.
Can you imagine?
Brings back the days of the command center. Purdue is the latest number one, according to the AP in the college basketball rankings. You can go to Purdue's Twitter handle and retweet the tweet they put out for Purdue basketball. Back-to-back years now, the Boilers have reached number one spot under Matt Painter.
I think that's what Todd just went to do when he walked out of the studio. Go retweet that.
Throw a party, pop some champagne.
Nobody knows what Todd Meyer just left to go do.
There's a party in the executive producer's office right now.
Well, as he was quick to point out to us as well, though, the college football ranks of Purdue, still searching for a coach.
Need a coach.
Need to figure that out.
You'll get a number one ranking and like it.
Exactly. You can take solace in the fact that at least on the basketball side of things, that was wild. I was going back and rereading where, you know, projections were to start the season, and dark horse picks were Purdue to win the Big Ten. When you look at like where rank and...
I mean, they were unranked a matter of...
Yep.
3 weeks ago?
And for those that are wondering, Indiana remains at 14. They do not fall after their loss to Arizona.
Nor should they.
Yeah, I think that's... I mean, again, it's it the larger...
Where'd Arizona go? Sorry.
Arizona? 9. So they went up one spot.
That's it. Wow.
The larger thing that I focus on as the season unfolds is more... I mean, I don't want to say the bracketology aspect of it, but I don't... We'll pay attention to the top 25s as often because it's often, more often than not, you can find your top seeds there, right? But for the most part, it's all just, it's the hype of the season as it unfolds. Not to say you don't celebrate it and being ranked top team in the country, but there's so much fluctuation within those rankings and so early in the season that, I don't know, I'm not as live or die by it. But nevertheless, whenever you get an opportunity to be the top spot and in back-to-back years, impressive accomplishment. And now you see... Where do they fluctuate the rest of the season? Because once you reach the top of those rankings, that's often, at least amongst fans, and oh, now we're 15th because we lost to so-and-so. So that's the fluctuation of it that I like to watch a little bit more than just being there for the first week.
Is it a little concerning to you, though, that they were such a veteran-led team last year and they got the number one and then immediately lost, and now they're such... No, to be fair, they do have some veterans, but a majority of their... reliable players, some of them are freshmen. Does it concern you that that veteran-led team lost the number one so quickly a year ago, or is this a situation where they're so young that they just not going to worry about it and they don't know any better than just to continue winning?
That, and I trust Matt Painter. I trust him regardless of if it's a veteran group or if it's a young group that's out there with some veterans mixed in like they have with different pieces this year. I trust Matt Painter. I think he's one of the best coaches in the Big Ten, if not top two, top three, year in, year out. Purdue has an incredibly consistent program because of what Matt's done there. You're going to have your bumps and bruises along the way. Like, for instance, they're obviously not number one, and I don't know where the rankings would react had they lost to Nebraska on the road, but they passed that test. Will there be bumps along the way somewhere? Yes.
Always.
There is for everybody.
Always.
So I don't react as much to that. My bigger concern is who is... When we live in a society that is so often of instant gratification and, you know, it's tough for young players to then get lost in the weeds of a season at times, who is guiding the program, even though he hasn't been there as long. I would say the same thing about Mike Woodson in Indiana. Regardless of who is on the court, he has been around the game of basketball and knows it better than anybody. I'm not as worried for those teams because of who is guiding them and who is walking them along that path.
I will say the reputation that Painter has built in West Lafayette, I could think of a dozen programs probably around the Midwest where if what happened to them the last 2 years in March happened elsewhere, fan bases would be calling for heads. But the reputation that Painter has built and how much that community trusts him, and probably because he has spent a majority of his life at Purdue University, but I could think of a good amount of programs, Jimmy, that would not be too happy with their basketball coach coming into this year.
I completely agree with you, but I would also argue that, look, everybody wants to win the national title, right?
Everybody.
Like everybody, even when we talked with Coach Michael Lewis last week, and you know, I was trying to phrase to him, like, where do you want to be this season? And he immediately was like, we want to win. And every coach wants that. Every coach wants to compete. Maybe not everybody's going to say around, we're going to win the national championship this year. Like, they're not bust, you know, beating their chest like that. But, of course, that's expectations. Everybody wants to get there. When you raise a bar to a certain point, like Purdue has done the last couple of years under Matt Painter, and you've had deep runs in the tournament, and then the last couple of years you've had your heart ripped out, you have to balance program stability and I still believe in this guy with knee-jerk reactions of they've had two rough matchups in terms of just mismatches that they weren't able to overcome. Should most programs overcome the likes of North Texas and
St. Peter's?
Yes, but that's the beauty of March Madness. And that's why it's so tough to judge coaches, particularly coaches that have such a body of work of wins, over just what happens one weekend in the tournament. It all depends on where your program is, where their expectations lie.
It's the blessing and the curse of a month. Go ahead, Eddie.
Right before we get a break, I also want to give a shout out to one of my friends. He's at USI now. He went to Lebanon High School, graduated there, started his collegiate basketball career at University of Indianapolis. Then he goes to Nebraska. Now he's at USI. Was just named Player of the Week for the OVC, Trevor Lakes.
Hell yeah.
Congratulations.
It's awesome.
All right.
22
Command Center game. Claps.
Woo! Also, woo! They knocked off Indiana State. Indiana State was 9-1. They beat Indiana State over the weekend. So congrats to Stan Gerard and the Screaming Eagles.
Man, that is quite the win. I saw Indiana State earlier this year. They put 100 on North Dakota State. North Dakota State's not bad. So that is a major win for Southern Indiana. I'm Brendan King. That's Jimmy Cook. Eddie Garrison in the big chair spinning the dials today. Chris Denari, the television voice of the Indiana Pacers, is going to join us next. Big hour coming up. The voice of the Oakland Athletics, Ken Korach at 1:30. Greg Rakestraw at 2. Stick with us. We are with you until 3 p.m. on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
The Ride with JMV.
I hold no animosity, anger, or jealousy. In fact, I think Seth Wickersham is a fantastic writer. I just don't care to read or hear anything more about why Andrew Luck retired. Put that in the trash can with class basketball, Pete Rose in the Hall of Fame, Ryan Grigson, all that stuff. I don't care about it, and I don't think you do either.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3-6
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Hey, JMV and fellas, this Christmas, give her the next best thing to wearing nothing at all with the soft, silky, naturally nude pajamas available at pajamagram.com. Sensuous and smooth, naturally nude pajamas feel just like her soft skin, even more alluring than lingerie. The texture and the touch of these pajamas, so seductive that you'll both love the feel of them. Order today, and Pajamagram will include a free matching naturally nude 90. That's a $75 savings on a best-selling holiday gift. Yes, ordering today gets you a free $75 90. Best of all, Pajamagram does the wrapping for you. Free gift packaging in a year filled with the unexpected. Get her something she can count on. Order today. That's pajamagram.com. Again, do it right now. That's pajamagram.com to order naturally nude pajamas. Again, naturally nude pajamas. Order today. That's pajamagram.com. And tell them JMV sent you. Hey, JMV and fellas, need an annual health exam? I recommend going to Low T Center to get your complete health assessment. They will check all of your levels, not just your T level. In most cases, it's completely covered by your health insurance, and if you don't have insurance, it's less than $100 for a full lab panel and an office visit with their medical provider to give you a complete health assessment. Low T Center specializes in men's health care. Go to lowtcenter.com now to book online. That's Low T Center, reinventing men's health care.
In the construction business and tired of dealing with the indifference of big corporate suppliers, Quality Supply and Tool on South Harding Street understands. For over 25 years, owner Kevin Ane has had a different approach.
We at Quality Supply and Tool take pride in being a locally owned family business committed to service. And every customer's needs are different, and we truly believe in shaping our business to our customers' needs. That's what separates us from the competition.
That's Quality Supply and Tool with additional locations in Bloomington and Jeffersonville to serve Hoosiers better. Partner with Quality Supply and Tool and think outside the box. Store.
Knockouts Haircuts for Men is the new place to trust with your hair care and grooming.
Knockouts is a high-end full-service salon for men. They pamper you while you relax and enjoy a precision cut. Top-notch stylists and barbers.
Every style.
Cuts, fades, all hair types. Beard care, color, and waxing available.
At Knockouts, get a complimentary beverage with any service.
Knockouts Haircuts for Men.
Two Indy locations.
US 36 and Avon next to Tropical Smoothie Cafe. Clearwater. And Clearwater Keystone next to Drake's.
Walk-ins welcome.
Or appointments at 288-0007 or knockouts.com.
I always wanted to learn Spanish, but I never thought I'd have the time. Then I discovered Babbel.
Babbel's lessons are fun. They only take like 10 or 15 minutes, and in 3 weeks, presto, you're starting to speak another language, like magic.
I love that Babbel's lessons aren't just robots talking. They're voiced by native speakers, so you get the pronunciation just right.
If you want to learn a language, there's no faster, easier, better way than
Babbel.
Babbel.
Babbel. Go to Babbel.com to try for free. That's Babbel.com. Babbel.com.
Need new tires? Skip the long appointments and bad coffee. With Go Mobile Tires Indy, order tires online and have them installed at your home or office. GoMobileIndy.com. We come to you.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
WIBC HD2 W298BB. WIBC HD3 W228CX. Indianapolis.
The Pacers are home to take on the Miami Heat this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
The Fan.
Welcome back to The Fan. I'm Jimmy Cook, Brendan King to my right, Eddie Garrison right across from me. Pacers homestand did not start the way they wanted it to. Well, it did, I guess, on Friday with a win over the Wizards, but following that, the Nets come into town. Second time they've seen them this year, they fall 136-133, and now a matchup against the Miami Heat tonight. Potentially, assuming he's listed as active, he's still listed on the injury report, but potentially the return of Victor Oladipo for the first time since his trade away from the Pacers. The voice for Bally Sports, Chris Denari, nice enough to take some time with us today. Chris, how are you, sir?
Hey, I'm doing great. How are you guys?
Doing great. Thank you again for making the time, as always. Your observations, got a W, obviously, on Friday night, and then Rick Carlisle, obviously, frustrated with the 136 points given up, and particularly the dominance on the glass that the Nets gave them on Saturday night.
Yeah, those are oftentimes the scary games. I mean, they were without their five starters, their top seven scorers, but they've got guys that are hungry, and you saw that, especially in the fourth quarter. A guy like Cam Thomas, who was a terrific scorer at LSU, was a rotational player last year, but really hasn't played that much this year. I mean, he just went off. They went 15 for 20 in the fourth quarter, and the Pacers just didn't play with enough force. You know, it's I don't want to compare it because the Pacers are a different team than Golden State, but, you know, it's what happened last Monday. The Pacers go into San Francisco, no Halliburton, no Turner, and, you know, Andrew Nembhard has a 31-point game, and the Pacers beat Golden State. What I've said is there are a lot of talented players in this league, I think the parity is probably as good as we've seen it in some time. When you look at the standings, there are a lot of teams right around 500. You know, look at the Miami Heat. They had the best record in the East last year, and they're 12-15. So each and every night, you just got to be ready to go. And, you know, to give up 29 offensive rebounds and 37 second chance points on a night, guys, where offensively it was your best night of the year. You shoot 55% from the field, hit 21 threes. Tyrese Halliburton goes for 35, hit 7 threes. You know, offensively, you did more than enough to win, but you have to be much better defensively than they were on Saturday night, no question.
Chris, it's Brendan. Yeah, I was going to say, just like last year in mid-January when they went on the road and beat the Lakers and the Warriors on back-to-back nights, that Golden State game was in overtime. It was like the Kiefer Sykes game, you know? So you just never know what's going to happen in this league. But to just put a bow on, Chris, the Western road swing, what do you think maybe Rick Carlisle learned about his team most from that long trip that started basically at Thanksgiving and just wrapped up a couple days ago?
Yeah, I do think, you know, they've realized that, you know, with the youth, they've got some depth. I mean, when you have, you know, somebody like Andrew Nembhard, who scores 31 in that Golden State game, Benedict Mathurin has been solid all year long. He's only been in single digits twice as a rookie. So when healthy, I think, you know, this team has some depth and has a really good young core. You know, Miles Turner has played really well. I mean, if you look at his numbers, they're all career best. 18 points, 8 rebounds, shooting 55% from the field and over 40% from three. Halliburton's playing well. So, you know, I think there's a lot of good things. If you would have told any of us, I think, back in August or September, that after that 7-game road trip, you'd be over 500 looking at the schedule, you would have taken it. Now, the schedule gets much more difficult now. You know, Miami tonight, Golden State here Wednesday. You go to Cleveland, who's off to a great start, the Knicks, Miami again in Boston, and the Clippers. So, this schedule, there really no off nights, right? This, I think one of the funniest stories that I remember when Brad Stevens took the job in Boston, and I ran into him that first year, and that was a year I think Boston won like 20-some games. And no disrespect to another school, but he goes, look, there are no Elons on the schedule in the NBA. There are 29 other opponents that get paid just like everybody else. So that's the thing, is in the NBA, there are plenty of talented players waiting for their opportunity, whether it's on the Pacers or whether it's on, you know, the opposition. And I think you see that each and every night.
Chris, expectations going into the season were a mixed bag, depending on where you looked. Some people thought they were going to be back in the lottery, and as a one of the teams that were taken, Victor Wembanyama. Others thought that, hey, this is a nice young core, maybe they can make some noise as the season goes on. They proved the latter through the first stretch of the season, and now we're starting to enter that little second window of the campaign. What have you learned over these last 10? Obviously, the West Coast trip was tough, like Brendan mentioned. Important to take care of business when you can at home, but as you mentioned, the schedule is getting tougher and tougher along this stretch. What have you learned, and what do you need to see out of this group to know that they can arrange themselves in a position to get back to the postseason?
Well, they've got to be better defensively. I mean, there's no question about that. They struggled early, and then I thought in November they were a top 10 defense, and you know, maybe have taken a little bit of a step back here. Especially at the end of that road trip with the Sacramento game, the Utah game, and of course Saturday night's game against Brooklyn. So I think that's an area that they really need to, you know, make sure they're better. And surprisingly, they were a pretty good rebounding team early, and that has gone away. I think they've been out rebounded 8 of the last 11, and that will really get you in trouble, because as I said, guys, you look at the offensive numbers. When you shoot 55% from the field, make 21 threes, you figure you should win the game. But when you look at some of the other metrics and giving up the second chance points in the offensive rebounds, you've got to do a better job there. So, you know, there's no question about that. You know, tonight it'll be interesting, because traditionally the Miami and the Pacer games have been very low scoring. You know, really games in the 90s because of the way that Miami likes to play. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of pace the Pacers are able to play against the Heat tonight.
Chris, you're leading me right into my next question. By the way, Chris Denari, the television voice of the Indiana Pacers, is with us on the guest line, brought to you by the Mower Shop and Fishers and themowershop.com for all your snow blowers, commercial and residential mowers, plus service and power tools. Yeah, so Chris, the last time Miami was at Gainbridge Fieldhouse, November the 4th, Pacers win that one 101-99. To be fair, Jimmy Butler did not play for Miami, but Jalen Smith did not have a point that game. Chris Duarte, that was the game he hurt his ankle. And then Ben Mathurin, that was really the coming out type game where he scored 23 points in 37 minutes. So do you expect that same type of score, right around 100 points or so for either club?
Well, that, you know, I was looking back at last year. The Pacers beat the Heat in overtime, and it was a low-scoring game. In fact, I made a note here. since 2021, the combined points between the Heat and the Pacers are 197. So that means both teams are roughly under 100 each. And that's the second lowest in a building other than when Boston and New York have played four times at TD Garden. So it tells you that traditionally in this series, they have been low scoring games. And, you know, for Indiana, they've just got to get back to, you know, from a defensive standpoint, you can't give up 136, like you did the other night. I mean, I think, you know, it was more manageable. You give up 111 to Washington. Yeah, you can live with that. I mean, I think there are good offensive teams in this league. And, you know, to think that in 2022-23 that you're going to hold teams into the 90s, that's just not the way the game is played anymore. I mean, there's more three-point attempts. I mean, the scores are going to be higher. So, you know, my metric is you need to keep them in you know, the 105 to 110 range. If you can do that on a nightly basis, you're going to be in pretty good shape.
Chris, where for you, not just against the Heat, but just over this stretch, because you could tell post-game with Coach Carlisle there was a lot of frustration on the defensive end, and I know you quoted it earlier, but giving up right around 116 points a game, give up 29 offensive rebounds to the Nets. That was their most since 2015 in a game. Where does that start, and how do you kind of snowball this effort of getting things back to a proper standard? I mean, maybe not best in the league, but definitely not towards the bottom end of the league where they're at right now in terms of points per game.
Yeah, you've got to be, from a rebounding standpoint, it's got to happen at all five positions. I mean, you just can't look at Turner and Smith and those guys. I mean, you've got to rebound from the guard positions. You've got to do that. What's interesting, too, is if you look at certain teams in the league, some teams prioritize offensive rebounds and some don't. And, you know, in this day and age, Quinn made the mention the other night is it's a little bit of a fundamental thing, but it's sort of the way the game has been taught maybe over the last few years is guys don't block out as much. And so, you know, I think that's still the biggest thing. Whether you're blocking out or not, you got to be physical. You got to have a body on somebody. You've got to make sure that you keep guys away. The biggest thing was, you know, I talked to Ron Noren after the game, one of the assistants, and, you know, the first thing he mentioned was, I think there were a couple of offensive rebounds on missed free throws, and you just can't have that. So that's something that they've got to do a better job. And again, if you can clean that up, they do enough other things well to win games.
Chris, the athleticism of the bench, I think, has been evident over the last few weeks. Guys like O'Shea Brissett, guys like Aaron Nesmith, guys like Isaiah Jackson. I know sometimes their minutes are a bit fluctuated, and it really depends on the night, but having the athleticism, just let's call it those three guys, how much does it help the starting five that you can bring one of them in and kind of get the same defensive intensity on some of the stars from the other team?
Well, I think that's one of the biggest things that this team has over past teams in recent history is they're just way more athletic. And in this day and age, you've got to have that. And, you know, the Pacers are one of the top teams in forcing turnovers and scoring points off turnovers. And a lot of times that happens because of the second unit. I mean, T.J. McConnell came in Saturday night, had four steals. Nesmith, as you said, is a good athlete and a good defender. So that's sort of the mix and the match that Rick Carlisle has to use when he looks at his starters, when he looks at his reserves. I don't really get caught up in who starts. I look more at the combinations that they're going to use throughout the game. And then, for instance, you know, the last couple of nights on Friday and Saturday night in closing situations, O'Shea Brissett's been playing pretty well, so he's been out there instead of Jalen Smith. Some nights it's been Benedict Mathurin. So really, I think that's the way that Rick Carlisle looks at it. I mean, on Saturday night, the starters got off to a slow start other than Tyrese Halliburton. He was quick to take those four guys out, put four bench guys in that brought some energy and kept Tyrese on the floor because he was shooting the ball so well. So I just think at times, guys, it's, you know, Rick Carlisle will say it's a possession by possession. It's quarter by quarter. That's how he has to look at things on a particular night with the kind of rotations that he's going to use.
Chris Denari, DB voice of the Pacers for Bally Sports, nice enough to join us. Chris, it's a unique situation whether a former player comes back into town, especially unique with how topsy-turvy at times Oladipo's tenure here ended. What are you expecting, obviously, to be a Monday night crowd? It's a big matchup, old rival in the Heat. A lot of bad blood over the last 10 years with that franchise. But what type of environment are you expecting from Gambridge Fieldhouse and the overall vibe with Victor Oladipo making his return for the first time since that trade?
Yeah, I think it'll be, I mean, it'll be a lot of fun. I mean, you love the rivalry. Heat Pacers has meant so much over the years. And even though faces and names have changed, I mean, it's still those two jerseys out on the floor. And I think you go back, you know, to 12, 13, and 14, those were three really good series, two in the Eastern Conference Finals that, you know, Miami was able to get. So, yeah, I mean, Victor has not been back in the building since he left. You know, he went to Miami and last year was out much of the season due to injury, was out early in the year this year due to injury. So, he had some really good memories here. And I look back to the 2017-18 year when his first year when the Pacers took Cleveland to seven. That was an outstanding run. But, you know, times are different. Pacers are firmly entrenched with the group that they have. Victor's in Miami, and we'll let it play out tonight and see how it goes.
Chris, the injury report tonight for the Pacers, they're without Chris Duarte. How soon is he to returning to the floor?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, Rick Carlisle before the game on Saturday night really had no word. I mean, I think a few weeks ago they were hoping that he would be back during that seven-game road trip, but that never happened. And he's definitely somebody they miss. I mean, he had a 30-point game in Brooklyn just prior to going down with the injury, gives the Pacers another perimeter shooter, gives them some size, and, again, would create more depth out at the wing position. So, no word yet. He's been out in pregame warmups at times doing individual work before the game starts. I've seen him at practice. So hopefully it's sooner rather than later.
Chris, this is the last one from me, and I was just looking at the last box score, by the way, from the Heat-Pacers game in early November. Duncan Robinson had 0 points, missed all of his threes, probably can't bank on that happening again, but he's listed as probable with an ankle injury. My last question is about the matchup, Chris, we're going to see on the block, Bam Adebayo versus Miles Turner, and the way that Miles has played this year, the way that Adebayo has led the charge inside for the Heat, I mean, that has to be one of the better center matchups you're going to get in the Eastern Conference.
Yeah, and I think, you know, it really came out to a draw, which I thought was good for the Pacers the first time they played. Adebayo had 18 points and 10 rebounds. Miles had 16 and 7 and 3 blocks. And if you can do that, that's a win. Because when you look at individual positions, though it's a team game, you want to try to win your individual battle. And the Pacers will have their hands full. Tyler Hero had 29 the last time he was here, and I was looking. He's had 5 of 6 of 20 or more. In his last six, averaging 25. Butler has played in 4 of the last 5. He's been out a lot due to injury. He's averaging 25. So they've got a trio in Hero, Butler, and Adebayo that can all put points on the board. And then you sprinkle around Max Strus. Robinson hasn't played a lot this year. I mean, he's really fallen out of the rotation. But this is a Heat team that has struggled this year. Interestingly enough, shooting the three, that's been one of their strengths over the past few years. But, you know, it's the way the season has gone. Go back to Saturday night. The Pacers, if they win that game, and again, I know it's early in the season, we're a third of the way through, they're in fourth place in the East. They lose the game, they drop all the way to seventh. When Golden State and the Pacers played last Monday, Golden State entered the night sixth in the West, a loss to the Pacers, and all of a sudden they were 10th. And I think that goes to what I was talking about, guys, just the parity and the way all of these teams are bunched up in the East and the West. If you go on a little bit of a winning streak, you can really climb fast. If you lose 2-3 in a row, you can drop fast as well.
Chris, to your point about the parity, Chris Denari, nice enough to join us on the Mower Shop in Fishers hotline. Go to themowershop.com or visit the Mower Shop in Fishers for all your snowblower, lawnmower, apartments, equipment, business, and more. Chris, when you look at that parity that's present in both conferences, and as you mentioned, you can go up quick, but you can also fall pretty quickly as well. how long into this season before you and the rest of us will be comfortable with knowing what the identity of this team is and if they can be a playoff team this year?
Well, I think, you know, a lot of times you look at about 25 games in that you have a real feel for what you're looking at, and that's where we are, completed roughly a third of the season on Saturday. But things change because of road trips and home games and your schedule. So I think we'll know more over the next 2 weeks as this team hits the first of the year in 2023. I've seen a lot from this group. I mean, I've been very impressed with how they've, for the most part, handled things. I mean, the other night was only the second game they've lost when they've had a lead in the fourth quarter. The only other game this year was the Denver game at home. If you remember that, they had a late lead. So I think they've done a really good job of putting themselves in position to win games because, again, I don't think anybody was sure what we were going to see when the season started because you're playing so many young guys. I mean, think back to the Golden State game. Think back to the Minnesota game. The Pacers, in some instances, were playing three rookies. I mean, Kendall Brown was getting some minutes in critical situations. So I think we'll know a lot more. I mean, we know a lot now, but as the season progresses and, you know, you put more games in the record book, I think you'll have a little better feel when we get to January 1 what we're looking at.
Chris, this is your 17th year covering the Pacers, and I don't want to step away from anything else with the rest of this rookie class, but the shiny new toy, the new object's like, ooh, I want to see what this is going to be. And Bennett Mathurin, rightfully so, drawing eyes. You're not going to put a bow on his season yet until it's done, but through these 27 games or so of the year, what have been your takeaways with him? Maybe not compared to other stars that you've seen or budding stars, but what have been your takeaways that you've seen from him out of the rookie from Arizona?
Well, just his confidence. I mean, he plays with a swagger and a bravado in a very positive way. He's a very confident individual, and even when he gets knocked down and even when he's going through stretches like he is right now, he's not shot the three very well the last few weeks. He still takes those shots because you need to take those shots, and he attacks the basket. You just don't see rookies get to the free throw line as much as he has. And so I think, you know, he's 20 years old, and you just sort of think about, hey, what's he going to be like in the next 3 to 4 years? And then you say the same thing about Andrew Nembhard, what we saw at Golden State, what we saw over a five-game stretch where he averaged about 16 points per game. You have to feel pretty good with those two guys that as they mature, as they get even more productive over the next 2-3 years, those two guys are going to be pretty special in a Pacers uniform.
Chris, we know you're in the grind of the regular season. Always appreciate you making the time for us. Have a good call tonight. Enjoy it, and look forward to talking to you down the road.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Chris.
That is the voice of the Pacers on Bally Sports. Chris Denari, nice enough to take some time with us again on the Mower Shop in Fishers Hotline. Go to themowershop.com. Or visit them at the Motor Shop in Fishers for all your residential, commercial, whether it's snowblowers, lawnmowers, whatever the case may be. The Motor Shop has you covered.
Are you a push mower guy or riding mower guy for your house?
Push mower.
Old school way?
I mean, it's the
yards. You go tarps off in the summer?
What'd you say?
You go tarps off in the summer?
No, I do not. No. I have a white NBA Summer League t-shirt that I'm repping while I'm doing the work. We're not, no, I don't. Yard's not big enough, though, to justify the riding mower. If we had like a massive acreage of some kind, I'd probably be more in that.
Well,
camp,
when you make your first million, you can buy the riding mower.
That is Brendan King. I am Jimmy Cook. Eddie Garrison manning the controls. We are going to step away in just a moment. We're going to be, Joe, I'm going to let you take this one because he's voice of the A's. Longtime connection there with Ken Korach, and looking forward to getting an opportunity to talk with him and figure out with post-winter meetings what's next for baseball.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I just saw Sean Manaea, the Indiana State guy who pitched so long for the A's. He just signed with the Giants today. So that leaves the A's with a little bit of a hole in their rotation. Now, Ken Korach is one of the best dudes and smartest baseball minds out there. So if there's anybody you want to talk about with hot stove stuff, it is Ken Korach. And, I mean, he's been on the call, Jimmy, for a long, long time on A's games. I mean, he called the Jeter play, the little Jeter flip. And that, you know, obviously it's one of the most historic and standout plays in MLB postseason history. So, and he got to be on the call for that. So pretty cool.
Whenever you have a long career like that, you're going to have opportunities to be a part of special moments. And yeah, you're right, a very special moment in that regard. Well, Ken Korach of the A's Radio Network set to join us here in just a moment. If you have any questions on the YouTube chat you want about the hot stove and just in general with regard to post action after the winter meetings, put them in there. We might get to some of those for Ken as well. It's Ken Korach, bottom of this hour, next segment, in fact, and then top of the 2 o'clock hour, Greg Rakestraw, more Colts, how they prepare for the Vikings this weekend. Jimmy Cook, Brennan King on The Fan.
This holiday season, DraftKings Sportsbook app is giving Indiana Pacers fans a special gift. Everyone can get a no-sweat bet on every Pacers game this December. Head to the DraftKings Sportsbook app, opt in under the promos tab, and place an eligible bet of your choice on a Pacers game. If it doesn't hit, you'll get your money back in a free bet. With payouts bigger than ever, DraftKings Sportsbook app is the place to go to bet on the NBA. Download the DraftKings Sportsbook app now. New customers can sign up with a promo code 1075FAN and get a no-sweat bet on every Pacers game this December. Go to the DraftKings Sportsbook app and opt in today to receive this limited-time offer only at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the Indiana Pacers. Must be 21 or older, Indiana only. Max reward limits apply. One free bet issued based on amount of initial losing bet. Eligibility restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.draftkings.com/basketballterms. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
People here are raving about QC Kinetics and how regenerative medicine has changed their life. People like Helen, an avid mountain climber who got sidelined when an accident left her knees in constant pain.
I was not able to train or do really anything on my knee.
Helen was told surgery would be her only option. But then she found QC Kinetics and was treated with natural biologics designed to repair and restore tissue in her knees. 3 months later, she was climbing the highest mountain in North America.
I got a very quick resolution to my pain. I began treatment in March, and I summited Denali June the 7th. It was super successful, and I recommend everyone seek out QC Kinetics as an alternative to surgery.
Get your life back with lasting results. No surgery, no drugs, no downtime. Call QC Kinetics today.
Call QC Kinetics, 317-559-PAIN. That's 317-559-PAIN. 317-559-PAIN. That's 317-559-PAIN.
This holiday season, Diamonds Direct gives you the gift of 0% interest financing for 3 years on any purchase. With high prices and high interest rates everywhere else, Diamonds Direct is here with the incredible shopping experience you need. Our guaranteed best value prices will save you money. And with 0% interest, you can spread your payments over 3 years with no finance charge, period. And for this holiday season, we're showcasing an expanded selection of affordable and timeless holiday gifts. Rings, earrings, pendants, bracelets, colored gemstones. And if you're upgrading her diamond or getting engaged over the holidays, we have one of the largest diamond selections in America. All sizes and shapes, all cut for maximum brilliance, and all offered at our amazing direct importer, no middleman prices. Check out our holiday gift guide now at DiamondsDirect.com. Buy now or come into the showroom. Let one of our experts guide you in finding the holiday gift that's at the top of their list. And enjoy 3 years zero interest financing on any holiday purchase. Diamonds Direct. Your love, our passion.
Hey, it's JMV for my guys John and Chris Love at Love Heating and Air Conditioning. Predictions are this could be a colder winter than normal, and you need to make sure your furnace is safe, efficient, and working properly before you have a breakdown on a sub-zero day. Get that recommended service right now from Love Heating and Air Conditioning, and the Love family will waive the $95 trip and diagnostic fee. I trust them, so should you. They're the best. Love-HVAC.com or 317-754-0754. Tell them JMV sent you. Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in plumbing. That's Lance and his local team at LD Smith Plumbing. 317-284-9526. Let's talk about 83 of free involving any drain in your home. Means LD Smith is going to come out, make sure your drains are clogged free for $83, or the visit is free. That's 83 of free at 317-284-9526. The best in plumbing, Lance and his local team, online, ldsmithplumbing.com.
Dan Dockage for Affinity Whole Health. Affinity is the leader in testosterone and hormone replacement therapy, and I got to tell you, I see why. Since I started a testosterone replacement program with Affinity, my energy, mental focus, drive, everything is up, and the physical benefits are amazing. Check them out at feelgreatindy.com. Guys, you can improve the way you look, the way you feel. You can build muscle and lose fat. Affinity will give you the roadmap. Go to feelgreatindy.com. That's feelgreatindy.com.
JMV is back on the road this Wednesday, 3 to 6 p.m. at Twin Peaks on East 82nd Street. Stop by for grub and ice cold beer. Thursday, the Tavern Tour continues featuring Larceny Locks and Lunazool Shots from Coach's Tavern downtown at 28 South Pennsylvania from 3 to 6 p.m. Friday, it's JMV with another Bud Light Blue Friday from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Stop by and enter for a chance to win a pair of tickets to the Colts versus Chargers, all part of Bud Light Blue Friday.
Man, B-Dubs really has everything for football season. Fresh draft beer, big TVs, and saucy boneless bar pizza? Oh yeah! To make things even more legendary, they're teaming up with the Colts to offer you a free app anytime the Colts get a defensive takeaway, which is an interception or a fumble recovery in any game all season long. Valid at participating Indiana locations, free appetizer includes anything on the bar food section of the menu except house sampler and three bird dogs. Visit Colts.com/BWW for terms and conditions. Please drink responsibly.
This winter, there are new COVID-19 booster shots designed to help protect against recent Omicron variants. Schedule your updated COVID-19 booster dose at vaccines.gov. Sponsored by Pfizer and BioNTech.
It's Kevin and Querry.
Matt Miller, ESPN.com, draft analyst.
The total number of quarterbacks that will go off the board that you can build around.
I think top five is safe because there are really three quarterbacks, Bryce Young at Alabama, C.J. Stroud at Ohio State, and Will Levis from Kentucky. After that, there's a drop-off to Anthony Richardson from Florida, who could be the next Josh Allen, or he could be out of the league in 2 years.
Kevin and Querry.
Weekday mornings at 7
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Come on. 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
We are going to take the guest line brought to you by the Mower Shop and Fishers and themowershop.com to the Bay. The play-by-play voice of the Oakland Athletics, a guy that has played a major part in my career, helping me out with baseball play-by-play, all kinds of great tips. And listening in during the summers, it is Ken Korach, who has been on with myself and Jimmy before. Ken, great to catch up with you, my friend. And I guess just right off the bat, hot stove in Major League Baseball, the winter meetings just finished up. Your thoughts, Ken, on what the market has been right now with Trey Turner getting $300 million, Judge $360 million. It's been quite something.
Yeah, you're right, Brendan. Thank you. It's amazing amount of money that's been spent for sure. And also, I think you look at the years too. You're talking about plus $300 million and players getting 10 years, 11 years. So it really has been an explosion in terms of the contracts. That's for sure.
Ken, has that caught front offices by surprise, or just pundits of the game by surprise? The particular guys, to your point, that are in their 30s. Are not only nailing down these high dollar amount deals, but also long-term 10-year deals that, you know, maybe 5-7 years ago, teams might be more hesitant to give those out?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I think because teams were reluctant if a player was 31, 32 and thinking, what would that player give them when he reaches his late 30s or early 40s even perhaps. But I think sometimes the teams look at that as the cost of doing business. If you really want to get the player and you have to go to 10 years and you're that intent on signing the player, you know, I really think that teams think that if we can get 7 or 8 really productive years and the last 2 or 3 years aren't so great, that that's the cost of doing business, that you give up those last 2 or 3 years just because you understand or you feel like that's the cost of doing business to acquire that player.
Ken Korach, the play-by-play voice of the Oakland A's, is with us. Ken, does that, to you, further maybe separate the big market clubs from the small market clubs? Because I would imagine a team like Tampa, a team like Oakland, would be a little bit more reluctant to give a guy that amount of years with that amount of cash as opposed to New York or Chicago. So what does that do to the market, you think?
Well, it does, and it's always been the case, I think, so this is nothing new. I'm kind of rooting for the Twins because, you know, they're still in there on Carlos Correa.
Yeah.
So I think it's healthy for the sport when it seemed like the Twins can step forward and make a move. I mean, they're really intent on re-signing Korach. But, you know, I think in the case of a team like the A's with our ball club, I think a lot of it depends on where your revenue stream comes from. And you know, the A's need a new ballpark. I mean, that's the biggest thing as far as Oakland is concerned. There's a lot of money in the game going around, I think, especially because of the TV contracts and new media and all the digital aspects of baseball and merchandising. So I think you're always going to have a disparity. I think when it really becomes accentuated is when you have a situation like where the A's are at, where their revenues don't match up with the market size that they're in.
Ken, I was going to ask you about Korach, but just to touch on the ballpark, is there an update there on if that is further along to getting built, or really in the last few months has it gone kind of quiet?
Well, we're hopeful, that's for sure. And, you know, I'm bullish on the A's, and I'm bullish on the Bay Area. It's a two-team market, and the A's have been in the postseason, you know, parenthetically, 11 times beginning with 2000. So they've really been successful. It's been pretty remarkable what they've done. But, you know, right now they're on the two tracks. They're still talking to the people in Vegas, talking to people in Oakland. But they're kind of in this limbo position, which is not a real positive place to be in. So I'm hopeful that that a decision will come down fairly soon, and the ball club can really have a direction and move forward and have some positive things in the not-too-distant future.
Ken, has the years-long conversation about trying to get an arena or a new stadium established or what the future holds for Oakland, has that at all been a shadow around the organization as they're trying to complete objectives such as the winter meetings, or are they at a point with their operations where it's just a storyline that's always going to be talked about because it's been such a prominent issue for so long and they're comfortable still running the day-to-day?
No, I think it's for sure. I think the former, and David Forstie, as general manager, talked about it during the winter meetings. When you, at that point, when the A's have a real solid direction as far as where they're going to be in a stadium and all the plans are in place, then, of course, you can budget for the future. And I think you always want to know, kind of have an idea of where your revenues are going to be at. And so the A's have talked openly about that. So that will really give them the chance to have a more solid path going forward and a sense of what their revenues are going to look like.
Ken, back to the market just briefly. So the winter meeting shortened by a day. I don't know how much that actually did to change things, but were you surprised that Korach and a guy like Dansby Swanson came out of the winter meeting still unsigned?
No, not really. I mean, there was plenty of activity for sure.
Yeah.
And I think with some clubs, they look, maybe they have their top two or three choices. And maybe your top choice is shortstop with somebody else, but now you have to pivot. And so the agents aren't going to give in and just have their guy sign for less than what they think that player is worth. So I was not surprised at all. And I think that the market is still really hot for guys like Korach. Carlos Rodon might be looking for a 7-year deal with a kind of a checkered injury history. So, no, I think it's a hot market. It'll stay that way.
Ken Korach, nice enough to join us, voice of the Athletics, taking some time with us. Ken, a lot of rule changes continue to be reviewed by the MLB and the MLBPA year over year. Got a question from our audience from Matt Allen. Wanted to know if you think that the MLB is trending towards, and I know this is a very polarizing topic, but the idea of an electronic balls and strikes system, maybe not obviously this coming season, but in the years to come, if that's a realistic trend as they continue to experiment with different things in the minor leagues.
I don't think it's going to happen in the big leagues. What I do think you'll see will be a challenge system. So I'm really dubious as far as going like full on with the computerized strike zone like they've had in some of the minor leagues. But I do think you'll see kind of a hybrid of that from the standpoint that you'll still have home plate umpires calling balls and strikes, but maybe the managers will get three or four challenges during a game. I think that's going to happen. I think that'll happen as soon as 2024. Mm-hmm. Just my guess, but I do believe that's going to happen.
I mean, Ken, I've texted you about this multiple times through last summer with the South Bend Cubs, with the pitch clock coming along and you know, the limiting of a pitcher being able to throw over to first base. I mean, you get three opportunities too, and if you don't pick off a guy on the third, he goes to second automatically, which was an interesting rule through the summer. But the pitch clock really, Ken, did a massive thing to shorten games. I mean, we were averaging, no joke, man, 2 hours and 5 minutes sometimes to play a ball game. We played six or seven games in under two. So I don't know if that's going to translate to the big leagues exactly that way, but your thoughts on the pitch clock coming in?
I don't think it'll be quite that dramatic in the big leagues, but I think it'll have a major effect, and I'm all in for it. I was never in favor of these things like the shifting and the rules involving outlawing the shifts, but I'm all in. I'm 100% in. I think it'll be a good thing for the game.
What is on your wish list the remainder of this offseason for the Athletics, Ken? And how do you feel about the moves they've already made as they establish themselves for 2023?
Well, you know, they haven't done a whole lot. So I think they're still in that kind of rebuilding mode. So the most important thing for me as far as their club is to have that sense that the next really good team is down the road, that we can see on the horizon the really good players that will make up the next contending team for the A's. Because even when the A's have struggled in the past, they've turned things around pretty quickly. They're kind of in a deeper hole right now than they have been in the past. You know, they have several holes, and I think they're going to be a little more aggressive. You know, the work stoppage last year it really affected their ability to make moves in the delayed start to the season, the lockout. So I think they're going to be a little more active than they were last year. But the most important thing to me is that the young players develop and we can see a nucleus that A's fans can really hang their hats on.
Ken Korach, the radio play-by-play voice of the Oakland A's, with us on the guest line, brought to you by the Mower Shop and Fishers and themowershop.com. Ken, this came out just a few hours ago. Sean Manaea is heading across the bay, going to the San Francisco Giants. I think I read 2 years, $10 million. Of course, a Valparaiso native. He played at Indiana State here locally and pitched that no-hitter for the A's back in 2018. So Manaea going to the National League and across the bay to the Giants, Ken. What do you think Oakland's going to miss out on him most?
Well, you know, he was with the Padres last year. So.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
That's right. So he did come over from San Diego and was a free agent. Had a tough year with the Padres last year. His ERA was almost 5. You mentioned that no-hitter against the Red Sox, which is one of the, you know, the great highlights for the A's in the last several years. Just an amazing night at the Oakland Coliseum. I think there's an opt-out in there. I think the money might be a little even more than what you had mentioned, Brendan. So they're looking for a bounce back from him. Opt out after the first year. There's a lot of pressure, I think, on the Giants to even make a bigger splash. They really were in on Aaron Judge. You know, they signed Mitch Haniger, who's a good player, and he's from the Bay Area. But I think the Giants feel like they have to make one more really, like a really big move to feel like they had a successful offseason.
Ken, last question on my end. You talked about at the top all the money being spent across Major League Baseball. A lot of people oftentimes like to throw jabs at the MLB because, oh, the NBA and the NFL have more flair, more flavor. But what is the amount of money spent? And as you mentioned, stadiums being built and media rights deals still being fought after. Talk about the health of baseball as it stands in 2022.
Well, I think this is going to be a really interesting year. Because just what you guys had mentioned with the rule changes. So this is really the most dramatic shift that we've seen in baseball, maybe even since the advent of the DH in the early 70s. So this may be a seminal year for baseball. So I think the game is still in really good shape. Obviously, we've talked about the money that's been spent. So from a fiscal standpoint, the game is really healthy. And I think the way we'll see how fans react to the rules changes and see how all this goes down this year. I think we'll go a long ways toward determining kind of the direction baseball is headed.
Ken, you got to see some pretty darn good ball clubs in the AL West this year. One of your division opponents, of course, World Series champions again, the Houston Astros, who win 106 games, and they do what they do in the postseason. Heck of a run. Dusty Baker gets his first World Series. I guess, Ken, after seeing the Astros as often as you did in the regular season, why, in your mind, do you think they were the destined World Series champions?
Well, I think because they were the best team. I mean, that's the obvious answer. But then I was thrilled for Dusty. I think this solidifies his Hall of Fame candidacy. I think he was a Hall of Famer even before the year, but I think it was now this has left little doubt. One of the great, classiest figures in the game for decades now. Then they went out and they signed Jose Abreu to play first base.
You're right.
So, even, you know, they lost Verlander, but they still have so many good young arms. I don't think it's going to have a major impact their starting pitching, but I think they'll survive that. So they have a chance to be really good for the next several years. The Mariners went out and did some things. They were really positive. They got Colton Wong to play second base. They traded for Teoscar Hernandez with Toronto. I think the Angels have improved their club. The Rangers, somewhat surprising that they gave Jacob DeGrom 5 years, I think, like $185 million, right? So it's a pretty strong division, that's for sure.
That is a whole lot of cash. Last thing, Ken, before we let you go, you mentioned the Hall of Fame. One of the really cool things of the Hall of Fame that happens yearly is the Ford Frick Award. Our good buddy Pat Hughes, the radio voice of the Cubs, picking that up. Just your thoughts on Pat going to Cooperstown.
Well, thanks for asking. I'm so thrilled for Pat. And I've known him for years. He's a guy from the Bay Area, the South Bay, went to San Jose State, influenced by the great family tree of Bay Area broadcasters, Bill King and Lon Simmons and Russ Hodges, who also received the Frick Award, John Miller, of course. So yeah. He's incredibly deserving. And this was a special Frick ballot for me because so many candidates, good friends of mine, guys I've kind of come up with in the business. So they had the choices they had were tremendous. I can't imagine. It was a really hard ballot as far as narrowing down the final selection. So, but Pat is really well deserving. Thrilled for him.
That's awesome. Well, Ken, I know how much you learned from Bill King as well, and you guys were brought up in that era. So good for Pat, and looking forward to hearing from you more as the summers go along, Ken. Ken Korach, the radio voice of the Oakland A's, is with us. Ken, appreciate the time. Hope you and the fam enjoy the holidays.
Thanks, you guys. I really enjoyed it. Appreciate it.
Ken Korach, the play-by-play voice of the Oakland A's, who has been a major influence in my broadcast career. If anybody is ever thinking about becoming a play-by-play guy, highly recommend if you have the MLB package in your car, you're driving at 10 o'clock on a summer night, you can pick up an A's game starting at 7 o'clock. Ken Korach is one of the best. Market's been pretty crazy, Jimmy.
Yeah, I mean, you're seeing cash fly around left and right from not just top-tier teams, but also, I mean, you mentioned you'd like to see a little bit more action from small market health overall. But, yeah, I mean, money's been flying, and it's not done yet. Still a lot of big names out there. Ken's point about what the Twins are going to do if they're able to bring back Correa, because I thought that was going to be a one-year stop. A lot of people thought it was a one-year stop. That could be a very fascinating story to see play out.
Well, again, it's not like the Twins are a one-off either. I mean, their farm system's really good. At the major league level, they're solid. I mean, their starting rotation that, as of late, has been led by Joe Ryan, one of my good buddies who pitched for my club in the Cape Cod Baseball League. So the AL Central... And I was in Chicago this weekend. I was talking to somebody about the White Sox. Remember, people were guaranteeing the White Sox, let's call it 2-3 straight AL Central titles. Cleveland played a hell of a year with a young roster. The AL Central, the Royals seemingly are playing better ball now. The AL Central might be one of the more competitive divisions in baseball next year.
Yeah, when I lived in Chicago back in 2018, a lot of the local market hype was about this young core of the White Sox, that it's not here yet, but it's coming and it's going to be there. And you're right, the last, as you've seen those fruits come to fruition the last 3 or 4 years, or at least be officially labeled as they're going to be contenders and be playoff teams, been a couple bumps here and there, both from injuries and just from the nature of the game, that they haven't lived up to expectations yet. And now you have, like you mentioned, counterpunches being thrown and a very young nucleus by the Guardians that you look at a year ago in terms of the teams that are surrounding Indianapolis, of just where our markets cross and intersect, that division is going to be a fascinating one to watch next year.
And a team that I didn't even mention with that tangent was the Tigers. AJ Hinch is their manager.
Yep.
They've been bad, but they have a World Series champion manager. And if Javier Baez ever figures it out, those division games in the AL Central might be really, really good next year. That was Ken Korach, the play-by-play voice of the Oakland A's. Happy to have him with us here on The Fan. Greg Rakestraw is going to join us here at the top of the hour to talk all things Colts and whatever else might come to mind of Rake World Cup. The Indiana Hoosiers tonight in the College Cup National Championship. They take on Syracuse, so Jimmy, a chance for your alma mater to pick up another natty. Best of luck to the Hoosiers tonight. We will come back, chop it up a little bit more. Brendan King with Jimmy Cook and Eddie Garrison on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Country. I got some famous friends. Long neck, high strung, never broke my. Nobody plays more new country. 97.1 KFM.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes and Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Hey, JMV, sometimes you're just cruising through life and, well, something happens that's just not your fault. You're in an accident and it causes injuries to both you and your family, and those medical bills can sure add up quickly. That's where Paul Cruz at Paul Ritchie Law Firm can help. Paul is recognized by the Super Lawyers Organization and his peers as one of the top personal injury attorneys in Indiana. Make that free call to see if Paul can help you at 317-269-2509. Visit parrinjury.com.
At Eskenazi Health, our patients are treated with compassion and skill. That's why Eskenazi Health is looking for professionals who share our mission and are dedicated to serving the community. As an employee of Indiana's top hospital for social responsibility and community health investment, you'll enjoy excellent benefits, competitive pay, and unwavering leadership support. Learn more about Eskenazi Health careers online at eskenazihealth.edu/careers.
Do you need furnace or heat pump service and need to find a local, well-trained expert you can trust like Reinhardt Heating and Cooling? We'll find that American Standard dealer at IndyHomeComfort.com.
Hey, JMV fellas, I have a great Christmas gift idea for her from you. Sensuous and soft, naturally nude pajamas from Pajamagram. Order now, get a free matching naturally nude nightie. That's right now, Pajamagram.com. Pajamagram.com.
Download the Dan Dockage podcast at 1075thefan.com or wherever you listen to podcasts. Brought to you by Affinity Whole Health, the leader in testosterone and hormone replacement therapy. Affinity Whole Health. FeelGreatIndy.com.
Knockouts Haircuts for Men is the new place to trust with your hair care and grooming.
Knockouts is a high-end full-service salon for men.
They pamper you while you relax and enjoy a precision cut.
Top-notch stylists and barbers.
Every style.
Cuts, fades, all hair types. Beard care, color, and waxing available.
At Knockouts, get a complimentary beverage with any service.
Knockouts Haircuts for Men.
Two Indy locations.
US 36 and Avon next to Tropical Smoothie Cafe. And Clearwater Keystone next to Drake's.
Walk-ins welcome.
Or appointments at 288-0007 or knockouts.com.
Hey, it's JMV, and guys, if you've noticed a lack of energy, motivation, and drive, it could be low T. Schedule your complete health assessment at Low T Center. They now offer the convenience of monitored self-inject at-home testosterone treatments for just $155 a month, cash pay, or covered by most health insurance. If you don't live near a Low T Center or you just need the convenience of a home treatment, Low T Center makes it easy. Only your first two visits are in person. Go to LowTCenter.com now to book online. Low T Center, reinventing men's health care.
If you could bottle this,
Smith can shoot the three and hits the three.
Everyone will want some.
That's the kind of energy flowing around Pacers Nation. We are roaring.
Here's another three. Towards it.
We are ready to rise and show the world what we're about.
And here's Turner hammering it down.
We are revved up.
The Pacers battle Steph Curry and the defending NBA champion Warriors on their only visit to Cambridge Fieldhouse Wednesday at 7. Tickets at Pacers.com.
Catch another Bud Light Blue Friday broadcast with JMB from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Enter the football toss, and you could be the next fan to win a pair of tickets to see the Colts take on the Chargers.
The Colts head north to take on the first-place Minnesota Vikings. The coverage starts Saturday morning at 10 on 97.1 Hank FM.
And 107.5, The Fan.
Welcome back to The Fan. Jimmy Cook, Brendan King, Eddie Garrison, manning the controls. Coming up in our next segment, the great Greg Rakestraw, wearer of many hats, including post-game show host for the Indianapolis Colts. Going to take some time with us. Big news of the day, Jeff Saturday, speaking to the media, saying that Matt Ryan gives them the best chance to win, and that it appears they're going to stick with Matt Ryan the rest of the way this season. At least that's what it would appear the case would be. With four games left, you're saying he's your best chance to win, and you still want to win games for Jeff Saturday and company. I guess that's the horse that you're going to dance with the girl you brought, I suppose, BK. I have a hard time wrapping my mind around this entirely because the outlook is bleak for this team. You have no idea what they're going to look like in not just the end of this season, but by the start of next season, who their general manager is going to be, if Chris Bauer is going to be retained, if who the next head coach is going to be, because I would assume it's not going to be Jeff Saturday. And then if it's not Saturday, what's he fighting for right now? And if he's keeping Matt Ryan out there, when also at risk is if Matt Ryan gets hurt, guaranteed money's on the table. The idea of winning games to end the season, he gives her a best chance to win. I can't figure out if this is Jeff just wearing the badge or if this is legitimately he's gunning for these final four games to show he can be an NFL head coach and he wants the guy under center that gives him that best chance in his mind.
You know, I wonder if it, and this may be completely out of line, but I wonder if it's just a respect thing that Saturday as a football guy cannot just let go of benching a possible Hall of Famer.
I would argue that that's the same thing that folks around here try to run Reich out of town with Vinatieri. And if you want to be a head coach moving forward, if you're Jeff Saturday, you can't let sentiment moves like respect. But it's also weird because in those moments, the Colts were still playing for something. Now, I mean, you're not. You're not playing for anything. You're playing for jobs and you're playing for your livelihood next year. As a franchise, you're not playing for anything right now.
Well, I think it's a little bit more blasphemous now as opposed to was to Vinatieri because Frank had the prior relationship.
Sure.
It probably was tougher. And Frank, clearly, I mean, as Kev said on Friday with us, he's a top five human being of all time.
Right.
Nobody can argue with that. But his flaw at times was hanging on to the emotional string. For Saturday, he has zero allegiance to anybody on this team coming in. He was an analyst basically on this station every Monday morning with Kevin and Jake and the morning show at times. So Saturday should have zero allegiance.
Right.
And we are speculating if it is that he just doesn't want to bench Ryan because of the respect of a veteran thing, that's a problem.
And this tells me that they feel they've seen all they need to of Sam Ehlinger. Because Ursay and or Ballard would have a pull on that if they wanted to have him under center these final four games. When again, all it is baptism by fire for him over these final four games of the regular season. We're going to dive more into that coming up after the break. Greg Rakestraw, host of Colts Post Game, going to take some time with us to give his thoughts on how he spent the bye week and also where the Colts are at post bye week with these final four games to go before the 2022 season comes mercifully to a close. Alongside Brendan King, I'm Jimmy Cook. Eddie Garrison behind those ones and twos. Back with Greg Rakestraw next on The Fan.
It's Kevin and Querry.
It is time to bench Matt Ryan. In more ways than one, Matt Ryan just looks old. He throws it old. He processes it old. That might be the scariest part of it all.
Matt Ryan looked like the mall Santa who a kid just wetted his leg.
He's due about $17 million for next season if he were to get hurt. That would be absolute malpractice to play him at 4-8-1.
Kevin and Querry.
Weekday mornings at 7.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
People who suffer from arthritis are getting real pain relief with exciting biologic therapies at QC Kinetics.
The success rate is there, and there's no better way to treat yourself when it comes to dealing with pain.
Meet Tyler Vail, co-founder of QC Kinetics, who says they can't cure arthritis, but they can treat the pain.
If you think of the tide coming in and out on the beach and what it does, it erodes the sand, right? It can't stop the tide, but eventually when the sand or the beach gets bad enough, we backfill that beach with sand so that we get generations of enjoyment with that beach again. And the same thing happens with your knee or your shoulder or your hip or your back. We want to backfill the problems that have happened to this point. I'm not stopping the tide, so I'm not stopping the arthritis, but I want to get generations of enjoyment out of those joints again.
Call QC Kinetics now for your free consultation. Learn more about how restorative biologic therapies can get you real and lasting joint pain relief.
Call QC Kinetics 317-559-PAIN. That's 317-559-PAIN. 317-559-PAIN.
Hey, it's JMV, and sometimes the holidays bring not only added joy and cheer, but also increased expenses. Form Credit Union can help make the holidays easier with their unlimited cash back credit card. The money you get back from every purchase is applied right to your statement, making the next month's payment a little lighter. Plus, use your phone for secure mobile payments and get real-time alerts to make monitoring your account even easier. The unlimited cash back credit card at Form Credit Union. Find out more today. That's formcu.com to apply.
Last minute shopping? Good thing Ulta Beauty's first on your list. From gotta have it ready to go kits from Fenty and Benefit to cult favorite mascaras to simple yet perfect Ulta Beauty gift cards, we have gifts everyone will love this season. So get shopping, because our kind of holiday is you having your kind of holiday. Hurry to an Ulta Beauty near you or buy online and pick up in store. Ulta Beauty, the possibilities are beautiful.
Dan Dockage for Affinity Whole Health. Affinity is the leader in testosterone and hormone replacement therapy, and I got to tell you, I see why. Since I started a testosterone replacement program with Affinity, my energy, mental focus, drive, everything is up, and the physical benefits are amazing. Check them out at feelgreatindy.com. Guys, you can improve the way you look, the way you feel. You can build muscle and lose fat. Affinity will give you the roadmap. Go to feelgreatindy.com. That's feelgreatindy.com.
Don't sweat those extra guests. Get a Twin Peaks party pack. They're family-sized meals complete with an entree, choice of side, house salad, and buttered rolls for four. It's the perfect way to enjoy Twin Peaks from home. Order online for pickup or get it delivered straight to you. And skip the drama and get the perfect gift for everyone on your list. A gift card to Twin Peaks. You don't even have to leave your couch. Just head over to bit.ly/TwinPeaksGift to grab as many as you need and send them right to your fans' inboxes. Happy shopping.
Hey, it's JMV from my guys John and Chris Love at Love Heating and Air Conditioning. Predictions are this could be a colder winter than normal, and you need to make sure your furnace is safe, efficient, and working properly before you have a breakdown on a sub-zero day. Get that recommended service right now from Love Heating and Air Conditioning, and the Love family will waive the $95 trip and diagnostic fee. I trust them, so should you. They're the best. Love-HVAC.com or 317-754-0754. Tell them JMV sent you.
JMV is back on the road this Wednesday, 3 to 6 p.m. at Twin Peaks on East 82nd Street. Stop by for grub and ice cold beer. Thursday, the Tavern Tour continues featuring Larceny Locks and Lunazool Shots from Coach's Tavern downtown at 28 South Pennsylvania from 3 to 6 p.m. Friday, it's JMV with another Bud Light Blue Friday from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Stop by and enter for a chance to win a pair of tickets to the Colts versus Chargers, all part of Bud Light Blue Friday.
Crew Car Wash books make the perfect holiday gift, and right now buy four Ultimate Washes and get two free, available online or at any Crew Car Wash location.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan. WIBC HD2, W29 8BB, WIBC HD3, W228 CX, Indianapolis.
The Pacers are home to take on the Miami Heat this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
I'm Brendan King, that's Jimmy Cook, Eddie Garrison, around the horn. He is the Iron Man of the Indianapolis sports media community, because he does it all. Greg Rakestraw joining us on The Fan on the guest line, brought to you by The Mower Shop and Fishers, and themowershop.com for all your snow blowers, commercial and residential mowers, plus service and power tools. Rake, good to chat as always, my friend. Your thoughts as of 2:01 p.m. and Matt Ryan still being named the starting quarterback of the Indianapolis Colts.
Perhaps I'm done trying to figure out this group this year. Just because, and again, you can argue because of the Titans' loss yesterday that you are still mathematically alive for the AFC South because the Titans refused to put it away. But when you're at 4-8-1, I would love to see them run with Sam Ehlinger just to figure out exactly what you've got in him. Maybe they've already made up their minds as to what Sam Ehlinger is and Sam Ehlinger isn't. I don't think we've had enough of a snapshot yet to know whether he can be a starting level quarterback or not in the National Football League. I have been all about playing the young guys these last four games. I'm in an effort to tank. But just to, again, give you a fully developed picture as to, okay, what exactly is Sam Ehlinger? What exactly is Desmond Patton? What exactly is Mike Strong? What exactly is Nick Cross, et cetera? So at this point, you just kind of shrug your shoulders and move on.
Rig, Jeff mentioned last week and kind of reiterated it today that they have four games left to play for, everything on the line. And I don't know if he's referring to just him proving that he can coach in the National Football League and that he belongs here, and that's why he's sticking with Matt Ryan. But from a overall personnel standpoint, to your point, it's hard for, in my mind, Colts fans to look at this and anything but a clear indication that they, the Colts, have seen everything they want of out of Sam Ehlinger. Because I guess I get it. You're right. They still have little sliver of playoff hopes, but if they fall on against the Vikings on Saturday and that's off the table completely, and correct, they still stick with Matt Ryan, I feel like that's telling the fan base, hey, we don't have the quarterback right at West 56th.
That's the only logical sense to make of that. And again, I would probably lean towards that direction as well, but I've got a four-game window to know exactly what I've got. Well, maybe not even that far, but at least have a better idea as to what I've got. But again, there's a reason why they pay me for other jobs than coaching the football team. Let's put it that way.
Rake, as we approach Saturday afternoon football in Minnesota, I guess you could say one of the bright spots of the team, if there is one, has been how they have played defensively oftentimes this year. Not in the fourth quarter against Dallas, that's for sure, but a lot of other times too. Is the defense good enough to handle what Justin Jefferson has done this year?
I'm not sure there's any defense good enough to handle what Justin Jefferson has done this year. But at the same time, if you look at the two best teams in the National Football League, I think we could say the Kansas City Chiefs and Philadelphia Eagles. They're not the top two. They're two of the top three or two of the top four. Colts held both those defenses, both those offenses in check, you know, during the course of this season. You know, the Vikings maybe are regressing to the mean a little bit, kind of like the Giants have done, kind of like the Seahawks have done. Jefferson can really play. You've got a guy like Gilmore that can certainly help slow him down. But do I think the Colts will keep him in check on Saturday? Absolutely not, because seemingly nobody else is doing that either.
Rick, I still don't think it's fair from a Matt Ryan perspective, if you're truly scouting him as well these final four games and seeing, even regardless of what you do in the draft in April, if he's still a part of this team next year. The offensive line issues to me have been a major microcosm for his issues across the board this season. But when you look at how Ryman's played the last couple of games and hoping you can find continuity there, combined with the fact that the Vikings are giving up the most yards per game and the most yards per play in terms of a passing attack on their defensive front, if they underperform again this week, where does your outlook go on this offense in the final 3 weeks and beyond if they're not able to put up decent numbers in the passing game against a Vikings team that appears to be reeling in that department?
I'm not sure, given what the Colts have done offensively on a week-in, week-out basis, whom the Colts are playing, if it matters, to be blunt about this.
Sure.
I mean, let's think about this. We have felt good about the Colts offense for how many quarters this year? For the entirety of the Jacksonville game, for the second half of the Titans game, for the first quarter of the last game they played against the Cowboys. I mean, it's somewhat comforting to know that the Colts are playing a defense that has given up a few more points this year and has been a bit susceptible to the pass. But that doesn't mean the Colts are good enough to take advantage of said opportunity. So, again, at this point, when you're 13 games in, man, you are what you are. And what the Colts have been has been an offense that has produced points consistently in the teens. That's not good. And a team that has consistently found a way to shoot itself in the foot with turnovers. Also not good. And it's a game on the road against a team that's going to be a playoff team. Again, that does not largely bode well for this football team. But will we see this Colts team make some plays? Yes, because that's what happens to the average to bad teams in the National Football League. You know, the team that this group so much reminds me of, and this is not a great comparison, Colts fans, would be the 2017 Colts team that won four games. two of those against the Houston Texans. That was the year that Jacoby Brissett was the starter from week two on after the injury to Andrew Luck and after the disastrous Scott Tolzien performance as a starting quarterback against the L.A. Rams. And the reason I bring that up is that that Colts team had a lot of leads in the second half. In other words, the average to bad teams generally have some guys that can make plays too. So I can see the Colts making some plays on Saturday. But is it going to be enough to put together a full performance to win a football game? The recent odds would tell you probably not.
Rick, I wanted to get back to something you mentioned earlier about Sam Ehlinger and really not getting a look at him if this is the case in the next 4 weeks, if he doesn't dress. But does him not dressing and Nick Foles being the backup quarterback, does that lead you down the path that you had aforementioned about they maybe think Ehlinger is already not a guy they're going to use, so why not have Foles as a backup just in case?
I'll revert back to my earlier comments. I'm not sure there's much sense you can make at the Colts quarterback position right now. just because, again, you've seen now 11 games worth of Matt Ryan. Some good, a lot of bad, all of it his fault? Not necessarily. For whatever reason, you haven't played Foles to this point. You play Ehlinger and then decide to go in the opposite direction. And again, was Ehlinger as good as he was, you know, is he really as good as he looked against the Washington Commanders? Probably not. Is he really as bad as he looked against the Patriots? Dear God, I hope not. He's clearly somewhere in the middle. Again, do I think he's a starting caliber quarterback in the National Football League? Probably not, but don't know that for sure. So in terms of what the Colts depth chart at quarterback looks like, again, it's one of those things you just literally kind of shrug your shoulders, throw your hands up, and say, okay, because apparently different people look at it in completely different ways.
Greg, how does it change how we view this team and just the direction of what needs to be done this offseason moving forward when we joked about at the top they still have a chance to make the playoffs? Well, the team with the better chance to make the playoffs in division is the Jaguars. If they go 2-1 and the Titans stumble, all of a sudden the team that bounced you last year and embarrassed you once already this season that was supposed to be behind you and still a couple years away is maybe in the playoffs. How does that change how we view the Colts and just the South as a whole if the Jaguars are able to, they don't have to do much, Greg. They just got to go 2-1 and then beat the Titans.
It doesn't. It's the worst division in football, Jimmy. We're talking about a team that has a playoff chance, that has a top 10 draft pick. That's what we're talking about. You know, and where the Titans, again, have the gift of geography. Like Purdue in the Big Ten West, they have this gift of geography, and they proceed to fire their general manager and are reeling because of it. And again, the Jaguars are in a different spot. You know, the Jaguars are still a young football team under a proven head coach in Doug Peterson. And so the fact that they are starting to gain some traction potentially shows you, hey, things are heading in the right direction in North Florida. But in terms of the way we view the division, trust me, that story has been written. Even though we don't know who the division champ is yet, the story has been written. It's the worst division in the National Football League.
I guess I want to re-clarify that slightly because I agree with you. I'm not saying the South is suddenly elevated to the top of the AFC by any stretch of the imagination. What I mean is that you thought it was this, not you, but Colts fans or maybe the front office thought this was a two-horse race between the Titans and we're right there, we're always a contender, we're in the mix, we're going to win the South this year. And then all of a sudden, what people have been talking about since Trevor Lawrence got there was they're knocking on the door. Jacksonville might be turning a corner. And you talk about the experience with Doug Peterson and his staff. You make the playoffs as Jacksonville, even if it's the South, you're suddenly the third worst team in that division. And now you're back at the end of the line with the Texans in terms of where you're trying to go 2-3 years down the line.
I would also say this, again, because this has been such a surprising season of struggle for the Colts, I'm not sure I've, in my years of doing this, that I have cared less about how the Colts stack up with other teams in the division. Because for me, it is about, okay, how do you fix this in the offseason? How do you rebuild this? Is this the first true rebuild this franchise has had in 11 years? So how they stack up versus the Titans, which is obviously the perspective of Jim Irsay going into the season. How they stack up versus the Jaguars, how they stack up with the Texans, It's important, but the Colts have work to do just to get to the point where that is important. Right now, the conversation about the Colts needs to be, how do we stack up against the Indianapolis Colts? Do we have the proper pieces in place to be able to build something out of the ashes of this season going forward? And so, to me right now, it's not about how do the Colts look versus the Titans? How do the Colts look versus the Jaguars? How do the Colts look versus the Texans? And dear God, to be better than that, being the worst team in the football league. It's how do the Indianapolis Colts look? Period. Full stop. End sentence. I don't care about the other three teams right now. I want to see the Indianapolis Colts be better. That's my concern, and my guess would be that's most people's concern right now, too.
Greg Rakestraw is with us on the guest line, brought to you by the Mower Shop and Fishers and themowershop.com. Rake, I want you to put on your owner's cap right now. We're going to go full hypothetical. So after the season, whether they judge if Jeff Saturday is the guy or not, let's say he's not the guy and they need a new head coach. As the owner of the Indianapolis Colts in this hypothetical situation, would you want to go hire a defensive-minded head coach, or do you go get an offensive guy similar to Frank Reich? But if you go defensive, you'll probably need to reevaluate Parks Frazier as an offensive play caller, right? So if you hire an offensive head coach, that guy probably calls the plays. If you go defensive, you're going to need to go all in probably too on an offensive coordinator. Your thoughts?
If you are hiring a head coach, you hire the right guy for the job. And then you let that head coach put together his staff. Let's face it, you know, when it worked with Frank Reich and Matt Eberflus and Nick Sirianni, it worked because you had good people, even if they weren't put together in the order in which you normally had them, where Frank comes in and inherits Matt Eberflus, obviously brings Nick Sirianni with him. That worked, but what you want to do this time around, now 5 years later, is bring in a head coach and then say, okay, who do you want the pieces to be? If the head coach wants to keep either Parks Frazier or Gus Bradley next year, whether that's Jeff Saturday or somebody else, then so be it. You always work from the top down. And so there are things about Parks Frazier that I think everybody in the organization likes. Clearly, given the responsibility he's inherited at such a young age, that speaks very highly of him. But if you bring in an offensive-minded coach who wants to be his own play caller, if he wants Parks to stay here, great. And if not, Parks will find someplace else to work. Gus Bradley's defense has not been the problem this year. But if for some reason you bring in another head coach who is a defensive-minded guy who wants to bring in his own coordinator, then I'm sure Gus will find gainful employment someplace else. Start with the top and work your way down. Everything right now, you're not good enough to sweat the micro. You're worried about the macro if you're the Indianapolis Colts. Start big, work your way down.
Greg, we talk all the time. Greg Rakestraw, nice enough to join us. You can follow him on Twitter, at Greg Rakestraw, as BK mentioned, wearer of many hats, including in this conversation, post-game show host for your Indianapolis Colts. We hear so often, regardless what the record is, that people are fighting for jobs, they're fighting for livelihoods, not just this year, but next year. As you're looking at this team with not a lot to play for right now, where are you most focused on observing, hopefully, growth and improvement over these final 4 weeks?
Again, it's the young guys. I know what you have in Michael Pittman. I think I know what I got in Paris Campbell. And again, Paris, even though his numbers have tailed off, he's still been available. He's been healthy, and that has made this season a win for Paris. But I want to see the rookies here develop. You know, Bernard Raimann is learning from his mistakes and is getting better. That's a good thing. But I am all for, again, I want to know exactly what I've got on the 53-man roster if I'm the Indianapolis Colts. I want to have as much to nerd out on, as much data collection as possible going into the offseason to make the most educated personnel decisions that anyone can make. I want to know exactly what my roster is comprised of, knowing that, you know, what we thought was going to happen in 2022, basically the opposite of that happened in 2022. So I want to be as well informed about those pieces for 2023 as possible. So it's again, get the ball to the young guys, get more reps for the young guys on defense. There are certain pieces, you know. Hey, Grover Stewart's going to be a stalwart for you. DeForest Buckner's going to be a stalwart for you. Zaire Franklin's going to be a stalwart for you. To me, it's not about guys that you know are under contract. It's about the guys that are on their rookie deals or the guys that are coming up for free agency, those are the guys I want to know the most about over the last month of the year.
Rick, a lot of people like to try to read tea leaves. It's often a fool's errand, so I'll just ask you this, and if you want to spike it in my face, that's totally fine. But in terms of Chris Ballard and in terms of Jeff Saturday, can we read into anything that happens these final 4 weeks of the season in terms of what those two positions are going to look like next year, or is this ultimately going to be something that is not finished and finalized until with a comfortable answer until season's end?
I think it'll be a full snapshot of the season then. And again, in terms of Jeff, I don't think it has anything to do with win-loss record. More wins would certainly help, but I think it's the things that we can't see. It's how players interact with him. It's the demeanor in which he carries himself during practice. It's the way that he communicates with the remainder of the staff. It's things like that where, again, if he goes 1-7, do I think he's the head coach here next year? Probably not, but I still think it's about wins and losses. So I imagine those decisions get made in January, not at any point in December.
Rake, do you want to hit on some other football, specifically the College Cup, the national championship? That comes up tonight at 6 o'clock, Indiana and Syracuse. Rake, I think it's wild. I was listening to Soccer Saturday when I was driving on Saturday morning. Remarkable that the Hoosiers, they have not given up a goal in this tournament. How wild is that?
Given Indiana football as an IU soccer, it's impressive. Not altogether crazy. What is impressive about this group is that this is not as star-studded of a roster as they have had in recent years. You go back 3 or 4 years, there's 7 or 8 current pros that were on this team. A lot of guys playing at the USL Championship level, but others that are playing overseas or playing in MLS. Andrew Gutman, Trey Muse comes to mind, and Trey will be an MLS goalkeeper at some point in time. It takes longer for those guys to break through than say the position guys. There will be guys that will play professional soccer out of this group, but there is not the easy-to-point-to star out of this group. This has been a true team effort for head coach Todd Yeagley. This is kind of a program team. And when you have a program like Indiana, who has now reached a national championship game for a 17th time in basically their 5-decade history, that's just insane. But in terms of the star level of this group, it's muted from what it's been the last few years. You know, the recent guys, Victor Bezerra, now plays in Major League Soccer. Roman Celentano, who was the second pick in the MLS Super Draft, became the starting netminder for FC Cincinnati this past year, which is rare for a kid of his age to get that many reps on a playoff team in Major League Soccer. You know, Ryan Whitbrick's going to get a look. Tommy Mahalik's going to get a look. JT Harms, given how he has played, is going to get a look. But this is truly about the team, more so than, you know, a star player kind of carrying Indiana on this tournament run.
Rick, we're not going to have an opportunity to talk to you until the FIFA World Cup concludes. So your thoughts on the semifinal matchups tomorrow and Wednesday, and having you put on the pundit hat for a second, who you think walks out of Qatar as champions?
I think France makes it back-to-back. You know, I thought France and Brazil were the top two teams, you know, kind of going into it after the end of group stage. Obviously, Brazil got knocked out. What Croatia has done, it's hard to call a team that was the runner-up 4.5 years ago as an underdog, but they were against Brazil, and they found a way to win after that Neymar goal. To use the Brian Dunsith term, you know, that was done and dusted. Croatia had other ideas. Morocco is a wonderful story. You kind of think against France, it's probably where the run ends up coming to an end. But I think France is your champion by the time. If we speak next Tuesday, Monday, which is certainly on my plans, I would probably tell you that Le Bleu Blanc et Rouge will be holding the World Cup for a second consecutive playing of it.
Wait, Rake, we appreciate the time. Did want to ask you one more question before I let you go. We talked on Indiana Sports Talk on Friday, and you did the Danville game, I think, against Southmont, and we talked about high school basketball this year and maybe the parity of it we've seen over the last couple campaigns, and I thought you gave a really good answer, so I want to talk about it again here. About, are we seeing that same type of parity, you think, this year, or Are there, you know, four or five teams that you think are going to be the big boys at the end of it?
I think that four or five number is pretty accurate. You know, I had a chance to see the top three teams in the state in the rankings in Cathedral, Ben Davis, and Penn on Saturday. Marcus Burton was tremendous. Zane Doughty and Ben Davis were outstanding. Cathedral's got some talented pieces. They missed that linking piece of Tayshaun Comer. And when you lose your all-time leading scorer and really, if not a four-year starter at point guard, a three-year starter at point guard, his evidence is obvious, you know, for Cathedral. But Cathedral, when you have players, and Xavier Booker has been largely non-existent the last two Saturdays, he'll figure it out. It'll kick in for him at some point in time. So you throw those three teams in there. Brownsburg, I think, is a lot better than people thought they would be. I think the catching's kid has improved. It's caught up with kind of that potential that he has had out in Brownsburg. What Flory Badunga is capable of doing at Kokomo, you've got to throw them into the mix. So, and you know, don't sleep on Harrelson carrying Fishers, you know, for a great amount as well. So there are probably five or six teams that you would point to in terms of 4A. So if you consider that parity, great. Consider that top heavy, that's fine too. But it's not one team that you point to. Probably four or five that you look at. The best team, the deepest team, is Ben Davis. Doesn't necessarily mean they are guaranteed to win a state championship by the time March 25th rolls around.
Greg Rakestraw, you are the man. We appreciate the time very much, and we'll talk soon, my friend.
See you, fellas.
That is Greg Rakestraw with us on the guest line, brought to you by The Mower Shop and Fishers and themowershop.com for all your snowblowers, commercial and residential mowers, plus service and power tools. So you good with France?
Yes, I am. I love Morocco's story as a whole, but my dream matchup was an opportunity for Messi to maybe win the World Cup, and then one of my in-laws is originally from France, so they've kind of been my spirit team the last two World Cups.
We talked about that last year, didn't we?
We did. So I would love nothing more than to see France-Argentina in the final, and I am thrilled because anytime we are in the big chairs, anytime we're in this building, getting opportunity to talk about sports local and nationally, and there is daytime sports action of epic proportions going on. Both those semifinals, there will be money on the line, and there will be live bets, and it's just going to be a great time the next 2 days getting to watch that while we're in here.
You sound such like a degenerate.
Hey, I wear that badge with pride, my friend.
Jimmy's going to be all red, white, and blue.
Oh, I'm breaking out the Mbappe jersey on
not for us though.
On Wednesday.
Red, white, and blue for the other guys.
I will break out the Mbappe jersey on Wednesday. No doubt about that.
So. I love it. That's Jimmy Cook. I'm Brendan King. Eddie Garrison, your producer extraordinaire. We will come back next. Continue the chatter. 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Life has enough problems. Dragging heavy bags of salt to your water softener shouldn't be one of them. Avoid the salt hassle. Have Elgin Water Care deliver Pro's Pick Solar Salt right to your softener. Elgin Water Care has been servicing all makes of water conditioners and delivering Pro's Pick products here in Indianapolis since 1946. Give Elgin Water Care a call today, 317-251-9223. Get rid of your salt hassle with Elgin Water Care and Pro's Pick Salt.
Download the Dan Dockage podcast at 1075thefan.com or wherever you listen to podcasts. Brought to you by Affinity Whole Health, the leader in testosterone and hormone replacement therapy. Affinity Whole Health. FeelGreatIndy.com.
Knockouts Haircuts for Men is the new place to trust with your hair care and grooming.
Knockouts is a high-end, full-service salon for men. They pamper you while you relax and enjoy a precision cut. Top-notch stylists and barbers.
Every style.
Cuts, fades, all hair types. Beard care, color, and waxing available. At Knockouts, get a complimentary beverage with any service. Knockouts Haircuts for Men. Two Indy locations. US 36 and Avon next to Tropical Smoothie Cafe. And Clearwater Keystone next to Drake's. Walk-ins welcome. Or appointments at 288-0007 or knockouts.com.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in plumbing. That's Lance and his local team at LD Smith Plumbing. 317-284-9526. Let's talk about 83 of free involving any drain in your home. Means LD Smith is going to come out, make sure your drains are clog free for $83, or the visit is free. That's 83 of free at 317-284-9526. The best in plumbing, Lance and his local team, online, ldsmithplumbing.com. Purdue.com. Hey, JMV announcing the Kinetico Water System's end-of-the-year sale. Enjoy a savings blowout from now until December the 15th. Buy a Premier Series water softener. Get a K5 drinking water station free. You can even buy a Signature Series water softener and get 6 bags of salt free. $500 off an iron sulfur filter and get 50% off the Kinetic Salt Monitor and use that with the app anytime, anywhere. It's the Kinetico Water December blowout sale. Call today, 800-444-1387.
December 17th at Gainbridge Fieldhouse, introducing Indy's next basketball tradition, the inaugural Indy Classic. You don't want to miss this college basketball doubleheader featuring Ball State versus Illinois State and Purdue versus Davidson. The Indy Classic brings college basketball to the heart of downtown, and proceeds support the mission of Indiana Sports Corp. Secure your tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. Made possible by Indiana Sports Corp, Pacer Sports and Entertainment, and Russ Potts Productions.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly.
See the road ahead more clearly with Sylvania Bulbs and O'Reilly Auto Parts. Right now, purchase select Sylvania Bulbs and get up to a $20 gift card after mail-in rebate, plus 2x O'Rewards points. Replace your bulbs today and see better tonight. Let the professional parts people help you find the bulbs you need. Visit O'Reilly Auto Parts or O'ReillyAuto.com.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Hey, JMV and fellas, need an annual health exam? I recommend going to Low T Center to get your complete health assessment. They will check all of your levels, not just your T level. In most cases, it's completely covered by your health insurance. And if you don't have insurance, it's less than $100 for a full lab panel and an office visit with their medical provider to give you a complete health assessment. Low T Center specializes in men's health care. Go to lowtcenter.com now to book online. That's Low T Center, reinventing men's health care.
JMV is back on the road this Wednesday, 3 to 6 p.m. at Twin Peaks on East 82nd Street. Stop by for grub and ice cold beer. Thursday, the Tavern Tour continues, featuring Larceny Locks and Lunazool Shots from Coach's Tavern downtown at 28 South Pennsylvania from 3 to 6 p.m. Friday, it's JMV with another Bud Light Blue Friday from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Stop by and enter for a chance to win a pair of tickets to the Colts versus Chargers, all part of Bud Light Blue Friday.
Golf Performance Academy at Golf Club of Indiana's 6,000-square-foot indoor-outdoor golf facility is geared toward lessons, club fitting, practice of the full swing, and putting. Each hitting bay offers flight scope technology to track each shot and provide feedback. With 8 large-screen TVs, full beverage service, free Wi-Fi, and a conference room, they can provide opportunities for social and corporate functions. The Golf Performance Academy, the only facility of its kind in the state, even in the country. Call 769-3482 for more.
The Ride with JMV.
I hold no animosity, anger, or jealousy. In fact, I think Seth Wickersham is a fantastic writer. I just don't care to read or hear anything more about why Andrew Luck retired. Put that in the trash can with class basketball, Pete Rose in the Hall of Fame, Ryan Grigson, all that stuff. I don't care about it, and I don't think you do either.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. .5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Welcome back. Jimmy Cook coming to you live from the drivehubor.com studio with Brendan King. Eddie Garrison doing a great job as always, captaining the ship. Colts Vikings set to take place this Saturday. Gotta love the Saturday start within the NFL season. Always good to have more football every day. Football every day of the week. That's what I need.
We're gonna have the puns here. Saturday on Saturday.
Gotta love it. Get the presses hot and rolling. Additionally, and we mentioned this a little bit earlier in the show, as well as with our conversation with Greg Rakestraw, in general with where the Colts are, the only path, to Greg's point with how bad the South is, the only path for most of those teams to make the playoffs, and I felt this way when the season started, and barring major changes across the board in the South this offseason, the only path to get into the postseason is in the division. Trevor Lawrence, since week 9, 10 touchdowns, completing 71% of his passes, 1,300 yards passing, most of those near the tops, if not leading the entire NFL. what I was trying to get at, BK, is that while the Colts, Greg's 100% right, have to fix themselves before they can worry about anybody else, you always need to look behind you and see who's coming up to make sure that you're setting your standard towards we're going to be the best in the division. To be honest, they haven't been the best in the division in a long time, 9 years of counting, 8 years of counting, whatever the number is. Adding the Jaguars to the fray, and if Trevor Lawrence has, in fact, finally figured this out, it puts a ton of pressure for what this team needs to do, not just in this offseason, but just as a whole, to have their best ticket to the playoffs, which is winning the South. I mean, I'm not saying, like, live in fear. The organization isn't going to do that, but the Jaguars can't be ignored in this process, particularly if they somehow come back and win the South.
I'm kind of looking at this from a down-the-line perspective. So you talk about the Jags, and okay, so whether or not they make the playoffs, Trevor Lawrence has taken a huge step.
Yes.
With how he has played over the last weeks. But if Davis Mills continues to be the quarterback for Houston into next year, and if Ryan Tannehill continues to regress as he seemingly has been, and who's the kid they drafted? Malik Willis?
Yes.
If Malik Willis ends up not being what they anticipate, at least now that could be a process, and who knows what will happen with Tennessee if Tannehill's the guy or not, but it might take a little while for Willis. Depending on where the Colts draft, if they just poop the bed in the next 4 weeks or so and they just get themselves in line for the best possible draft selection, if they get in Bryce Young territory, which is really hard to do, and who knows what will end up happening in this draft, but if they get into Bryce Young territory and the way that I feel about Bryce Young and what he can do at the next level, if Davis Mills is the quarterback for Houston and they continue to go with Tannehill in Tennessee, or if Willis ends up not being good, it could be if Bryce Young is the guy that we think he is and the Colts get him somehow, some way, they could suddenly have maybe the second best quarterback in the division because Trevor Lawrence would then be the best quarterback in the division.
Right. No, I totally
agree.
Do you
see what I'm saying?
Yes. And that is why it's such a weird spot for the Colts to be in, because, again, it's not lost on me. Everybody that is either underneath Ballard's wing or underneath Jeff Saturday's wing that's on that staff and every single player and personnel in that office, no, they're not sitting there thinking, man, how are we going to lose to the Vikings this week? One would argue if you were being really coy about the whole thing, just keep doing what you're doing, baby. You'll be fine. You don't need to try. You'll be good. Let the results take care of it, and the L's will continue to follow. Unless you're getting a clear direction from ownership, which clearly Jim Irsay doesn't want to do that, and I don't blame him, that, hey, we are punting on these final 4 weeks of the season, which just doesn't happen unless it's... some teams are just poorly
unless
run.
Unless it's the Dolphins from a few years ago.
Right. Yeah, it just doesn't happen in the NFL. I get that. That's fine. But there's a difference between what Colts fans should want to see and what clearly Jeff Saturday wants to happen, which is putting Matt Ryan out there. I would assume, given how Jim Irsay wants to spend money on quarterbacks the last 5-6 years, money is not an object to him. I understand that. I would also think, though, most people have money made, and you talk about people that are wealthy, they often get upset about smaller transactions because that's how they got rich in the first place. The idea of putting Matt Ryan back out there and he gets injured and all of a sudden you have guaranteed money tied to him, it's a huge roll of the dice that I'm having a hard time wrapping my mind around what the directive is from Jim Irsay and the Colts these final 4 weeks. Because clearly Jeff Saturday has the trust, I would think, of Irsay to make these moves, yet there is nothing left to play for other than pride and jobs. That's it.
Jimmy, I think the one thing that's interesting with this is that the Colts do still have like a very minute chance of making the playoffs.
Which, when Rake brought that up, I was like, oh my God.
It's very minute. And I think
it's 1%, I believe.
I think that's...
not dead yet.
Yeah, minute. I think that's the only reason why Matt Ryan is a starting quarterback. Colts lose Saturday against the Vikings, then I think you see Nick Foles or you see Sam Ehlinger. I don't think Matt Ryan is going to play once those odds of making the playoffs have hit zero.
And that's fine, I guess. I mean, you still have 3 games left to experiment how you want with rookies and with younger pieces to see what they have. But look, I hate to say it. I do. It's different when you're 1-5 in the middle of the year like they did a couple years ago and you have plenty of opportunities in front of you. There's 4 opportunities left, and not only that, you need 2 teams who the Titans, I guess I'll give you credit, have shown they're stumbling right now. Mm-hmm. I get that. And you will need the Jaguars to lose the momentum they've established and a couple other things to happen for the Colts to get in the playoffs. For me, it might as well be zero. It's been zero the last 3 weeks, barring divine intervention.
They're going to make a 30 for 30, boys. It's coming right up.
And clip, and I'm willing to put it out, clip this and talk about the moron in the big chair, Jay Cook and BK, that I'm over here saying they're done. They're done. It's foolhardy in my mind to keep trotting Matt Ryan out there when at this point you're planning for 2023. I'm not even saying tank right now, even though.
Yes, you are.
I am, right? As a fan, I am saying that. Let's get a better draft pick. But I'm willing to concede to the other side of fans, which is trot somebody else out there and see what you have next year. Because, BK, if you draft a Bryce Young or CJ Stroud, let's say they get in position to do that, you starting him year one?
I think
I don't know that I think you have to if you're content with letting him learn behind somebody. Matt Ryan is not a bad quarterback in terms of his IQ and the way he sees the game. Like, I understand that people know I'm a Chiefs fan and I'm going to use this all the time, but don't use the Chiefs then. Just getting to an opportunity, even though they're not going to be helpful, like Brett Favre famously was not very helpful with Aaron Rodgers, but he still got to sit behind him and learn from one of the greats of the game, even if it wasn't as receptive and warm as, say, Alex Smith and Patrick Mahomes. I'm fine with Matt Ryan being a placeholder for a quarterback you go draft. That's fine. But in terms of the rest of this year, you might as well kick the tires and see what the rest of your quarterback room is going to look like, whether it's Foles or whether it's Ellinger.
I think that plan would have worked perfectly 2 years ago. I think they've passed the point of no return with that. Because if they trot out Matt Ryan and he's worse than he has been this year, he's only getting older, and whatever happens in the offseason, we teased a little bit on Friday, do you make trades if you are Chris Ballard / the future Colts GM if there's a change? Do you make trades to the core? Do you split up the stars of this team? All of that, of course, ends up going down to Jonathan Taylor's name. Would you even entertain that? But I thought it would have been perfect. If the Colts held on to Phillip Rivers a couple years ago and they drafted somebody to learn under him, because Rivers at least could still play. He took you to the playoffs. Matt Ryan, with a 1% chance, I guess, has a possibility to go to the playoffs. But I don't think you can trot Matt Ryan out there, Jimmy, and then have the fan base know what's behind him if it is a Young or a Stroud or a Richardson or whoever. The fan base would be calling for Matt's head immediately if and when he has a bad game.
Here's my issue with that, and I completely agree with Jeff Saturday's comments today. All the turnovers that Matt Ryan has had, people can point to that. You can't point to the mobility because everybody knew about it, right? You can't just say, oh, well, he's not. Yeah, everybody knew he wasn't going to be mobile. He needed a better offensive line than he had. Yeah, and that's my larger point is that I don't know, and if I get killed for it, whatever, I don't know that Matt Ryan's career is done, because if he gets in the right system with someone that can actually give him time and protect him over the course of a full season, where now here we are week 15 upcoming and you're expecting the tolls not to have taken the hits to not have taken their toll to this point. That's not fair to Matt Ryan. Like, I fully believe this season is completely different if the offensive line and they had figured out left tackle play up to the bill of goods he was sold when he came here, when they acquired him from Atlanta. Like, Matt Ryan, I could easily see him on a roster next year somewhere that needs a quarterback that can protect him. I could also see him saying, you know what? This is fun. I'm done. I'm hanging it up. But the idea of having Matt Ryan as a mentor, assuming you improve the O-line and make other adjustments on offense, regardless who the GM is, I'm not mad about that. What I'm more mad about is, if that is your plan to have Matt Ryan back next year, why are you throwing him out there to the Wolves to get murdered by the Vikings and the rest of the schedule?
And I think that just comes down to Saturday. But again, when you're a mentor, you can't mentor somebody when you're just getting your ass whooped.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it just maybe it will work somewhere else, but it's not going to work here next year if the roster is worse next year than it is right now. Rick Pitino, wins are not walking through that door, Jimmy.
I agree with you on that. But I'm not, same way that a lot of people view jobs across the board. Look, I'm not rooting for anybody in West 56 to lose their job. But regardless if it's Chris Ballard or another GM, if the idea is to have somebody lead a rookie quarterback next year. And again, we're putting the cart before the horse a little bit because there are still four games left to play for and the playoff hopes are still alive. That 1% chance. I get all that. Matt Ryan, I'm fine with him guiding a young quarterback. To your point, Brendan, assuming the Colts make those adjustments. If they're not going to make those adjustments, it's like, hey, the left tackle answer isn't here this year, or we can't plug the holes on the line like we want to. We're sorry, Matt. We're going to let this rookie play out there. Okay, fine. Cut him. Get rid of him. Take the money saving and the cap hit that comes with it. That's fine. If not, and you're going to say we're going to improve the O-line, Matt Ryan is serviceable. The problem is now he's not. He's not serviceable because all these holes have continued to show up week after week after week. And the hits have piled up. And yeah, he's a shell of what he was supposed to be to start this season. There's no doubt about that.
I just have zero faith that they're going to end up making those moves. But I mean, 1% chance. How Jeff Saturday's Hall of Fame coaching career started on a Saturday in Minnesota. Could you? I mean,
I can hear the.
Write it right now.
Music. Yep. Yep.
Terrible.
We're going to step away. We come back. We'll have some bets to wrap up a fun Monday as well. Thoughts on Pacers Heat. Tonight at Gamebridge, Jimmy Cook and Brendan King here on The Fan.
Hey, it's Big Joe for your trusted local independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer, Kirby Heating and Air Conditioning. The Kirbys have been in business for nearly four decades, and son Robert says his parents' business practices won't ever change.
I love the way that they've ran the business, treat the customer right. Word of mouth is our biggest advertisement, so you treat people right, and they're going to recommend you 10 times more, so it's been great.
Call Jessica, Lloyd, Robert, and Adam at Kirby Heating and Air Conditioning at 317-892-3614. Kirby is your trusted local independent American Standard dealer.
How about this for the perfect holiday gift? Get moving again, pain-free. You can do that via QC Kinetics. They are the nation's leader in advanced regenerative medicine, taking unique protocols that use healing agents from your own body to target aching joints, repairing and restoring damaged tissue. So you can move again with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. Got shoulder pain, excruciating hip pain? You have any arthritis or lingering pain from an injury? Don't let them operate on you or give you more steroids. You call QC Kinetics with locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood and get a free consultation today. This is the future of joint pain management, and appointments are available as soon as the next week. So make 2023 the year you say goodbye to joint pain. Call QC Kinetics. That's 317-559-PAIN in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. Give QC Kinetics a call today. 317-559-PAIN.
Are you still looking for the perfect holiday gift? You know what I'm talking about. The one that gets passed around the room and you hear a lot of oohs and ahs. Then come to Shane Company. We put so much love and care into the fine jewelry we create. Our classic styles are true treasures. With our expertise and attention to detail, they can be handed down to the next generation and look as beautiful as the day you bought them. They're a great investment. We have diamond tennis bracelets, classic solitaire pendants, and styles with cultured pearls. Our diamond stud earrings make a wonderful holiday gift because they'll never lose that amazing sparkle. We have a wide range of shapes and carat weights to choose from, so it'll be easy to find studs in your price range. We also offer studs in a variety of colorful gemstones. And with Shane Company's generous upgrade policy, you can upgrade your studs at any time. Visit us in-store or shop online and enjoy free two-day shipping. It's never too late to give a gift they'll treasure forever.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business. Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Hey, it's JMV. Sometimes, too many times, bad things happen to good people. Good people get hurt or killed through no fault of their own. That's where Tony Patterson at Parr Ritchie Law Firm can help. Tony understands because he spent his career helping people just like you put their lives back together. He was honored by Best Lawyers as 2020's Indianapolis Personal Injury Lawyer of the Year. See if Tony can help you. The call is free, 317-269-2509, or visit parrinjury.com, parrinjury.com today.
Guys, solve your ED today with an intimacy guarantee only at the Indianapolis Men's Clinic. If you don't perform, you don't pay. Call the Indianapolis Men's Clinic at 999-9000, 999-9000.
Catch another Bud Light Blue Friday broadcast with JMB from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Enter the football toss, and you could be the next fan to win a pair of tickets to see the Colts take on the Chargers.
The Colts head north to take on the first-place Minnesota Vikings. The coverage starts Saturday morning at 10. on 97.1 Hank FM.
A singer in a smoky room.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
This is currently playing in Jeff Saturday's office at the Colts Complex. Don't stop, baby! 1%! Oh, man. Can it be done?
No. No, it can't be done. No, I feel very confident in that.
All you got to do is beat the...
I have a better chance of starting for France in their semifinal in the World Cup than the Colts do.
How's your conditioning?
I've been... My fit, I'm 100% fit.
Yeah, we're getting out there. Both of us are center backs.
Ready to go. Yep.
Ah, geez. Brendan King, Jimmy Cook, Eddie Garrison on the Fan. Jimmy, make us some cash.
The Jay Cook Plays of the Day.
This is me, all right? I'm not a athlete. This is my way. This is how I win.
Today's plays of the day, speaking of soccer, in the College Cup, going to take the Hoosiers to capture their ninth College Cup, yeah, baby, over Syracuse tonight. In Monday Night Football, going to take the Arizona Cardinals to win the money line over the New England Patriots.
I need a defensive performance. Jimmy, I need a shutout.
They're going to pitch it for you, BK. And in the NBA, going to scoop the three, take the Pacers plus three tonight against the Miami Heat. 500 last week, 1-2 on Friday. Plays on Twitter at the J. Cook.
Edward?
BK, you got anything?
What do you got?
I'm going to go back to the old crutch. We hit on it last week. Tyrese Halliburton, not the points this time, just the threes. Taking him over 2.5. It is minus 130, so there is a little juice there. But Miami, 28th in the association in three-pointers allowed. Okay. Middle of the pack when it comes to three-point percentage. And Tyrese has been pretty good at shooting the three at home, over 40%. You got anything?
Yeah, you know, first, I literally grew up with Max Strus. He was childhood best friends with
my
cousin.
That's pretty wild, dude.
I have a set of twin cousins, and I played golf with Max Strus every weekend, pretty much, growing up. And now I'm in a studio, and he's making millions of dollars. we're going to hit back the hockey bets. I went 1-1 on Friday. And this is going to be, as you guys continue to get to know us, this is going to be your system play in the National Hockey League. When Connor McDavid is plus money to score a goal, you take the plus money to score a goal. Mr. McDavid, the best player in the world, who we won money on Friday, if you took it, over 3.5 shots on goal. Mr. McDavid is plus 102 to score a goal tonight. I would highly recommend that those listening in the greater Indianapolis area take that. Also, I'm going to take the over 6 on two of the better offensive teams in the league, the New Jersey Devils and the New York Rangers. A little East Coast battle. Give me over 6. Let's win some money, boys.
We're going to have an opportunity to talk with us tomorrow as well, but last bet on my end. Action is at 2 o'clock, so we'll be well into the start of the second half of one of the semifinals tomorrow in the World Cup, but I'm going to take Argentina on the money line over Croatia. I'm also going to take that back. I'm going to take Argentina to advance because I don't like the... That's only a 90-minute bet. There's a good chance that could go to extra time or penalties.
You know what? That's smart by you.
Then I'm going to also take Messi as an anytime goal scorer like we did last week. Made you money on that as well. Even if you're not the biggest soccer fan, if you're looking for a sample size of how to become one, this World Cup has definitely given that to you. And at the very least, if you're looking to make some money, great opportunity. You can bet on everything from first goal scorer to if someone's going to hit the post. Everything is available for you on prop bets during the World Cup.
Oh, I got one more here.
Yeah.
It's not an official play, but just a lean here.
Oh, so this Pacers, is, so you're saying it, but it's...
I'm just... You can consider this if you wanted to play it. Pacers are 8-5 at home. Miami is 3-9 away from Miami. The Heat this year are 18-1 against the spread. Pacers are 15-12. Heat are 3.5-point favorites.
Give me that plus 3, baby.
That's
what I'm riding with.
So I was in Chicago this weekend for my friend group always does our Christmas party in Wrigleyville. We rent out one of the bars just down the street from Wrigley.
Nice.
Always a great time. There are 40, 45 people there. Shout out to one of my buddies, Jordan Galligan. He literally dressed as Buddy the Elf.
Awesome.
And was doing, He was doing the Buddy the Elf traffic jumps between the Wrigley intersections between Clark and Addison.
Sure. That's hilarious. So,
but I do want to say we were at a bar. We were at one of the IU bars in the city. Kirkwood's, I believe, is the name. They're an IU bar. And we were watching the England game, England-France game. And somebody, like a verified Twitter account, tweeted after Harry Kane made the first PK. It literally said, quote, "Harry Kane doesn't miss from the PK stripe." And then...
It's tough. I saw someone podcasting live talking about how great of a PK, somebody from England, and yeah, then it went wide. To bring it full circle regarding your friend that was in the elf costume, last week for Food Finders of Lafayette, Caleb First starred in a series of elf commercials walking around Purdue, and his Boilermakers currently, for the second straight season, number one in all of the land of college basketball. That one of the big news items of the day. The other one, of course, Jeff Saturday mentioning that Matt Ryan will be the starter this weekend against the Vikings to give him the best chance to win. I am so glad that that best chance to win is to keep the one percentage alive for the playoffs, because that's definitely a realistic possibility and on the table for certain, instead of trying to see if there's anything left in Sam Ellinger. That's the biggest thing for me, BK. Like, maybe someone comes out from the Colts, says, "Oh, it's not true. We still believe in Sam." Yet the fact that Ellinger's not getting an opportunity, unless there's something we don't know, like he's hurt or something, tells me everything the Colts need to know about Ellinger. The only way I would shift that opinion is if Eddie is right and they're keeping alive that 1% hope. And then once that is blown away by Minnesota this weekend, then you see Ellinger or Foles out there the rest of the way.
That'd be like when your buddy is 99% favored to beat you in fantasy, of 1% you come. That's like the ultimate comeback from 1%.
Is that a real world scenario for you tonight?
No, I think I have a 30% shot. I need the Arizona Cardinals to have 13 fantasy points defensively.
Yeah,
so pray for me, please.
I will wish you the best there. And in terms of fantasy football, that's, we're at that time of year, folks.
Did you make the playoffs?
I did. Like Eddie, I was a 2 seed this year. I got the bye.
Must be nice, eh?
So I'm looking forward to seeing where those matchups go. And again, we'll definitely talk about that a little bit more in the week. We're obviously going to big picture focus on the Colts. But if you have any questions via the YouTube chat, or you want to hit us up on social media as we get closer to what is the start of playoffs for some leagues next week, and then the continuation of playoffs for others. If you have any fantasy football questions, Colts or otherwise, we'll hit on that. And then, of course, just a very interesting week for the Colts, because to Greg Rakestraw earlier talking to us, Don Fischer as well, Chris Denari, Greg Rakestraw, this is clearly an opportunity for the Colts to see what they have from their young pieces. And I guess if Jeff Saturday's at his word, keep playoff hopes alive, even though the Jaguars have a better chance than you do.
But they're alive, yeah. Baby. All right, Eddie, set the line for me right now. Over under touchdowns for Justin Jefferson on Saturday.
1.5.
I think I'll have 2.
We'll see. He should have had one against Detroit, but the officials said he stepped out of bounds when he didn't step out of bounds.
So are the Lions a wagon?
I think so.
Are the Detroit Lions a wagon?
Yes, on Friday.
Dane
Brugler tomorrow, by the way. Any draft questions you have, send them our way. He does some of the best draft coverage on The Athletic. Dane Brugler going to join us, and we'll get to the thoughts of what the Colts need to do the rest of the way as they prepare for the offseason.
That is Jimmy Cook. I'm Brendan King. Thanks for Eddie Garrison doing a spectacular job, as always. Charlie Clifford is next guest hosting for the man JMV. We'll talk to you tomorrow. 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
It's Kevin and Querry.
Matt Miller, ESPN draft analyst.
I love